Hey guys, what's up? It is week 251. And before we start, I want to let you know a short that I was in that we shot a while ago called Amy is on Vimeo. There'll be a link below if you're interested. I have no control over, you know, like the price or anything like that. So don't ask me. But if you're interested in checking it out, you can rent it on there. It also stars Aaron Ryan and Jason Crow's in it a little bit. And it was directed by Dustin Mills. So yeah, it's a black and white kind of mystery, kind of crime kind of deal. Also, there are some corrections. Yeah, that's right. Last week when I was talking about the Flags of Iron, I mentioned that this looks like kind of like it possibly an inspiration to the Warriors. And I'm like, so I saw the year on this and I was just like, oh, wow, this is like 80. I think Warriors was 79. So I'm like, oh, shit, the Warriors came out first. But then again, if you look at the styles and stuff of the other kind of Shaw Brothers movies, they all have similar styles. So I imagine that, you know, Warriors probably took a little bit from some of the Shaw Brothers movies. And also when I was rattling off Richard Lynch movies, I noticed this because I go back and I edit and, you know, I double check because when you get old, you say stupid shit, and like when you're saying it, you don't even register it's a mistake until you go back and hear it, and you're like, wait a minute, what? Like, I hear myself, this is probably early signs of dementia or something like that. But I said that Richard Lynch was in Missing in Action. I really meant Invasion USA. I mixed up my Chuck Norris movies, which is pretty much unforgivable, I guess. Anyways, let's hop into the first review. And the first one up is The Legendary Weapons of China, another Shaw Brothers movie. And this one, let me get the year right on this one so I don't make any more mistakes. 1982. This is directed by Liu Cheng Lang. And that's not the... There's like a couple of the big kind of prolific directors, and he's one of them. It has a lot of familiar faces. I'm going to look on the back because I don't want to mispronounce their name. Alexander Fu Cheng, who died an untimely death very young, and he kind of plays a lot of the comedic characters in the Shaw Brothers movies. We also have... Liu Cheng Lang, Gordon Liu, of course. Gordon Liu is kind of he's like one of the bigger names in the Shaw Brothers movies. So this one, yeah, this movie's pretty crazy, pretty entertaining. So what we have here, this one, I don't want to say like it's convoluted because that's, it's always an insult, but it is not the easiest movie to follow, if that makes any sense to anybody. There's a lot going on. There's a lot of characters. So at one point, this dynasty, it basically wants to use this new method of kung fu that involves magic, and everybody uses it, and trickery and all this kind of stuff, and spells, and they think that they can go so far as to, you know, make this kung fu so powerful that it can stop bullets. So they keep training people to take bullets, and they're putting spells on them and everything, and it just, you see all this kind of stuff in the opening of the movie, and a lot of people are dying. So this upsets one of the people who kind of runs, one of the, I don't know, underbosses who trains people, and he decides to leave. They look at this as some sort of form of traitor, and he kind of disappears. So basically what happens is the head honcho sends a bunch of people out to track him down and take him out. He's been disguised as this like old woodcutter and everything like that, but there's like a slew of people out to get him, including this kind of young, like basically he's the best at the kung fu kind of magic stuff. And he definitely believes in it all, and he's out there to take him out. We also have a woman disguised as like a man who has like, you're not really sure what their motives are, but they're both seem to be after this guy at first. And then you have kind of like this badass guy as well, who looks very similar to the woodcutter. So like, I don't want to give absolutely everything away, but all these people have different motives to find him. And of course there's going to be some training or like some confusion. It's some good comedy in this one. Fu Sheng plays a guy who's hired to act like another guy, and that leads to some comedy elements as well. And the special features, David West has a thing about, it's called, what is it, 18 Weapons, I think it's called on there, or let me double check the name of the featurette on the disc. It's called David West on Legendary Weapons of China. Okay, so there we go. And he basically mentions just essentially that some of the stuff in this movie is kind of sucking out, like sucking the air or making jokes, basically not sucking the air, that's the wrong term, but like sucking the fun or poking fun at the genre as a whole. Fu Sheng's character basically fakes an intestine injury, and that was very common in another kind of contemporary director or of a contemporary of this director that worked there, Chang, whatever, he just done like a bunch of Five Venoms, and like he always had people's guts getting ripped out, and like that kind of stuff, and there's a lot of comedy elements and all that sort of stuff. So it's kind of almost like making some statements on it, and you can kind of see like some comedy elements and everything like that. So like if I were to pop this in as the first one I watched, I wouldn't catch on any of that. The featurette definitely helped picking that stuff up too, because like I said, I'm pretty relatively new when it comes to the Shaw Brothers stuff. I've seen only about 20 films or so, but they have such a vast catalog. And the thing is, like when you watch like you know them for the first time within the last 5 or 6 years, I'd say I saw most of my Shaw Brother movies. It doesn't stick with you like something that you saw a million times at a young age. And as you pile them on, like you notice similarities, but you need time with these movies for me to like pick up on a lot of the stuff. I do at least. But so the fighting in here is really entertaining. I thought some of this stuff is all the fighting in the Shaw Brothers movies I dig, but there was a really cool set piece and kind of like an outhouse type deal. It's like this bathroom that's put on the water, and they kind of directly dump into the water. And there's a couple people trying to, essentially one person trying to assassinate somebody and other people trying to protect. Well, they're like the assassins start fighting amongst each other. And there's this part where these two are under this crawl space, and they think this one person is their target. So like they're fighting each other underneath it, and it's like close combat in the most ridiculous way. Like they're throwing shit, and like the other person starts hearing it, so they get involved, and there's some other gang that's been hired to act like that. It gets really convoluted and crazy, but it's absolutely hilarious. And of course they're on top of a river, a shit river essentially, and you know exactly where they're gonna go. Somebody's gonna fall in that river, and of course that happens. That stuff is really fun. And this movie definitely showcases all the weapons you could dream of, and it does that great Shaw Brothers thing, like when you have a new character introduced that walks in, they'll say their name and their title, who they are and everything like that. Sometimes they'll be like so and so, and like kung fu expert or broadsword, like all this kind of shit like that. So they do that with weapons here. So like it is like they try to incorporate as many weapons as they possibly can, and they give you all that in the like the opening credits of people practicing with them and all that kind of shit before they set up the story. So like at the very end, they're gonna have this big showdown, these two that have this long history amongst each other, and they're gonna use all the freaking weapons. So anyways, in this one, Legendary Weapons of China, like loyalties change, people, all that kind of stuff changes in the movie, and there's some twists and turns. But at the end of it, I really enjoyed this one. I thought it was really cool, and I love the kind of the character, the main assassin who's gone out there, the young guy who kind of is always like kind of confused what's going on. He becomes almost the comedic element of the film as well, along with Fu Sheng in here. But the special features are as follows: you got English and Cantonese, but you also have audio commentary tracks. You have like three on here: one with Asian experts Mike Leader and Army of Amida, who did some other ones of the 88 films releases, an audio commentary with Frank Jejen and actor martial arts artist Michael Worth. Then we have an audio commentary with Asian cinema expert Frank Zhang as well. So it looks like we have one of him solo and one of him together. We also have Gordon at Shaw, interview with actor Gordon Liu. And I also mentioned the 18 Weapons, David West on Legendary Weapons of China. It was called 18 Weapons. And Titus at Shaw, interview with producer Titus Ho. And the original trailer, reversible sleeve, all that good stuff as well. So yeah, this is another good one from Shaw Brothers that I really was entertained by. Lots of good fighting, lots of good characters, and don't get your hopes up for like super gory murders and everything like that. This one is relatively clean in comparison to a lot of the other Shaw Brother movies, but I enjoyed it nonetheless. Good stuff. Check it out. Okay, this next one is a really bizarre movie. This is one that I actually had never seen. I remembered the cover art of Modern Vampires by Richard Elfman. There's some things I didn't know about this. If I would have known this, Richard Elfman directed this, I would have watched this a long time ago. Maybe I had heard it in passing, but completely forgot about it. If you guys remember the old VHS cover, I think I had it at one point. It literally was like this red cover, and it was really stylized to look kind of like almost like a crime vampire movie. Blade came out around the same time, so it was kind of reaching for that. But Modern Vampires is nothing like that. This is like a satire on Hollywood with vampires, which is a nice kind of like funny thing right off the bat. Richard Elfman is a wild director, brother of Danny Elfman, the composer. Of course, he was in Oingo Boingo. And so he directed some movies like The Forbidden Zone, which is a cult classic, very fun, very wild movie, and Shrunken Heads from 1994, The Full Moon Picture, which I think is actually one of the better Full Moon movies. I think it's very underrated in terms of that kind of like funness, and it's just a really fun movie. So Modern Vampires. So I was looking to really enjoy this one. I did not really know what to expect. It has a really big cast in here, and like the two leads are Casper and Van Dien, and an actress that I'm not too familiar with. I feel like she might be more of a newcomer. She's probably done 50 movies, and I'm just an idiot, but Natasha Gregson-Wagner. Well, 98 maybe she was. We also have Kim Cattrall, Craig Ferguson, Robert Pastorelli, Udai Kier, and Rudd fucking Steiger is in this movie. And if you listen to some of the commentary and like the introductions and stuff, Rudd Steiger is what, you know, got Robert Pastorelli in here. Robert Pastorelli, Rudd Steiger, both dead now, unfortunately. But it's also, it's nice, of course, to see Udai Kier in a vampire movie. As Richard Elfman says, the second he saw Udai Kier, he wanted in Blood for Dracula, he wanted to stake him. So that's why he ended up in the movie. So this is a weird one. Casper Van Dien from Starship Troopers shows up in L.A., and he's supposed to be banned from this place, but he shows it's been a long time. He meets up with all his friends, including Kim Cattrall, Craig Ferguson, Udai Kier, and they're hanging out and everything. They kind of do their thing. You see him go to nightclubs and this weird, like, silly thing where they're, like, feeding on lawyers, and there's some decent a bit of nudity there. And essentially, Robert Pastorelli runs this whole kind of area as a crime boss, and he's Dracula. He's an asshole. He doesn't like Casper Van Dien for a reason. At the same time, there is this kind of low rent kind of street vampire going around. She kind of doubles as a prostitute and then takes the guys out, whatever. And she's kind of going around and stalking and killing people and everything, but she's making a mess of things. So, like, a lot of people want her out of the picture. They can't really find her and whatnot. But it turns out that Casper Van Dien has, like, a history with this vampire and everything like that. And we're going to kind of have somewhat of a love story. So, the positives in the movie, I should mention, Rudd Steiger is Van Helsing. He comes looking for Casper Van Dien because he has a vendetta against him. And he doesn't have any help. He's very old. So, he decides to hire some L.A. gangbangers to give him a hand, which is absolutely ridiculous. Some of the humor in that kind of sense is dated, but most comedies don't. You know, a lot of the humor will not date perfectly. It is a little dated, but I cannot help but love Rudd Steiger's interactions with those characters. It's very funny. It's very silly. It's very 1998. So essentially what happens is you have Rudd Steiger running around LA screaming crazy things and possibly being an ex-Nazi. It sure seems like it. Casper Van Dien as the lead. Well, he's an actor that I never thought was, he never really won me over too much. I don't actually despise him or anything like that. He's a very, very attractive young man. I think both the leads are very, very attractive. And, like, I don't want to say they only got the role for their looks, but it's not really why or anything like that. I'm not saying that. They do kind of fit in this movie because they are LA characters and they have to be, like, beautiful and fit and everything like that. And it just kind of fits with it at the same time, but, like, the acting is a little stunted in scenes between those two, and I will say this. I think a lot of it is because the big fangs in their mouth. Now, Richard Elfman's a smart guy. I'm sure he probably thought it was really funny to have everybody have the giant fangs in there in that place in their performance that they got to kind of stumble around. No one says anything that there's actually vampires all around L.A. because, hell, everybody is a fucking vampire in L.A. So, you know, that stuff works, the satire, all that kind of shit. It's funny in that aspect, but I'm just saying, I don't think that Casper Van Dien is, like, the world's greatest actor or anything like that. The supporting is fun. Craig Ferguson's, it's just a bizarre performance, kind of strange seeing him in this. Kim Cattrall, I said it's got a nice cast, but just a lot of bizarre, weird characters, and I'm not sure how I felt about every performance in the movie, to be honest. Rudd Steiger shines, of course, he always does. And believe it or not, like, as crazy as he is in all the movies and, like, over the top acting, he kind of fits in with this movie. This movie did catch me laughing. Got me to crack up laughing a couple times, involving somebody being on fire trying to grab a garden hose and spray themselves down was absolutely brilliant. That's a brilliant gag. But all in all, I thought the movie was just okay for a first time view. I liked it. Some things, didn't like everything. It's clever. It is a clever movie. And this one could get better on repeated viewings, if that makes sense to anybody. The commentary with Richard Elfman and Casper Van Dien, I feel like it's an older commentary. They seem to be making references. It feels like it's probably shot when maybe this was released on DVD or shortly after the VHS or simultaneously. Udai Kier is very funny in it. Pastorelli's solid. He's playing Dracula, but it's not like... It's a kind of criminal element Dracula, if that makes any sense. It's nice to see that Blade in this came out around the same time. It's just like how completely different they are, to be honest, although their advertisement would suggest that they're not, but they are. The original title was Revenant, which also I know there was a zombie film made years down the line called Revenant. I actually prefer this cover art over the original cover art. I like that. There's a good special effects. There's a lot of shooting. There's some gore, all that kind of stuff. I think that's done fairly well. There is a gangbang in the movie. I'll let you guys find that out for yourself. So there's a new introduction by Richard Elfman, who I like seeing. And I know he's got a new movie coming out, which kind of blows my mind, like Aliens or something like that. It has Aliens. It just looks wild, like all his other movies. And then we have an old, I think, audio commentary with director Richard Elfman and actor Casper Van Dien. And Casper Van Dien and Richard Elfman, Casper sounds like a super friendly, nice guy. And Richard Elfman had mostly good things to say about everybody. I mean, he was a little iffy on Rud Steiger, but not like negative. He just said that Rud Steiger likes to take his time. So like at times they would argue and then they'd make up. And he's like, I mean, obviously he seemed to appreciate him being in the movie and everything like that. I mean, hell, this is also the writer of Freeway, Matthew Bright, I believe his name is. And he's a wild guy. Like if you see his movies, Freeway 1 and 2, and I think he partially did that Bundy movie as well. I think he directed those, or he wrote them. I think he directed Freeway 2. But anyways, Modern Vampires from Ronin Flicks. It has a lot of interesting stuff about it. Like I could tell, like, this is a movie that if people saw at a young age or saw it years ago and they're revisiting, I think that you have some more affinity for it than I would, like a first time view. Now if I go back to this, I might have, or if I watched it, you know, with somebody else, like I feel like it's better maybe as kind of a group or a group movie or something. But there is stuff, like a lot of like elements, and like you could pull all the satire and stuff. It kind of works in that aspect for sure. So that's Modern Vampires. Okay, this next one here is from Full Moon Entertainment, and this is actually directed by Michael Pataki, the character actor. This is Mansion of the Doomed. Michael Pataki is in like Grave of the Vampire and Dream No Evil. He's in a lot of movies. So this is a bizarre one. The actor I know most in here, I know that they're fairly decent sized actors. Richard Basehart is a name I know, but I'm not too familiar with him. Lance Hendrickson is in this bad boy, and of course everybody knows Lance Hendrickson. This is pretty early for Lance Hendrickson. I know he was in Piranha 2, but this is before. This is 76. The first thing I'll say about it is I thought the picture quality was really solid on this release from Full Moon. It looked really good. This is a weird, strange film that I actually had never seen, but I had heard things here and there about it. It's a bonkers kind of movie. I would say it has some similarities to something like Scalpel, if anybody's seen that, but only vaguely. I'm talking about kind of the surgeries. And then we also have kind of a headless eyes aspect too, because there's an eye murderer. So this is a weird film. We have Richard Basehart, who's a surgeon. He does research and everything like that. One day, him and his daughter are in a car accident. She loses her eyesight and it's his fault. He feels guilty about it. So he's constantly experimenting, trying to figure out a way to get her eyesight back. So eventually he crosses that line when he realizes you can take an animal and switch their eyes and it works. He crosses the line and he decides to take somebody and take out their eyeballs and give them to her. At first she seems okay, but after a while the surgery just doesn't take and she starts to lose her sight again. The doctor goes into a downward spiral, and before long we have a hidden cell in his house filled with eyeless people screaming and yelling. So that's kind of pretty much the movie. As the doctor kind of slips into madness and rips out more eyes, and we have surgeries and everything like that, and the daughter's kind of oblivious to the whole thing going on until she's not. But there is a couple genuinely great scenes in the movie. There is an escape scene involving a road, some traffic, that I was literally on the edge of my seat for. I thought that was really well done and just like nerve-wracking. It was super nerve-wracking and just well done. There's some good shots in this movie too, way the camera moves and everything like that. Like I was impressed with some of the camera work for sure too. Like you'll be following a character and they'll walk out of the frame and it will zoom in on something and kind of go into that, especially during that escape scene. Like I said, the camera work is really competent. And in fact, the directing's fairly competent too. And there is those iconic scenes in the film, but in between, you know, it feels a little standard. The stuff in the basement with the people screaming without their eyes in the prison cells and stuff is rather disturbing. And like, this is obviously kind of a take on Eyes Without a Face or any of those kind of storylines too, right? Where like some, or Fives or something, we have somebody that you loved who's hurt and you're willing to go to these extreme medical, crazy scientific experiments, measures to do that. Hell, even the movie Extreme Measures, it was basically about that with, you know, Gene Hackman and David Morris and Hugh Jackman, a bunch of other people. Not Hugh Jackman, Hugh Grant. See, there, I'm doing it again. I'm getting old. Getting fucking old sucks. So anyways, Mansion of the Doomed. As far as special features are concerned, there's not really anything on here. I think there was just some trailers. If you're interested in seeing, you know, crazy medical experiments of people losing their eyes and kind of in a gothic big building, southern kind of gothic thing. It feels like, I don't know if it's even in the south, but it sure feels like it's probably LA. I feel like it is LA because of the traffic and everything. Anyways, I guess that would be bumper to bumper. Don't listen to me. Mansion of the Doom, check it out. Enjoyable movie from Full Moon from 1976. I know they had a DVD of it, but this one has definitely got to be an improvement. This is also, you know, executive supervision, Albert Band, Charles Band produced it. So check this one out. It's good stuff. I was thoroughly enjoyed it. It would be a good, like, kind of B movie picture with something else. It's one that I like put on the check mark that I seen. I'm like, I'm glad I watched that. Mansion of the Doomed. Okay, next up is the last two Santo movies. The first one is Santo and the Blue Demon versus Dr. Frankenstein. This is an 8 Blu-ray set, and these two are the last ones. So yeah, let's get into Santo versus Blue Demon versus Dr. Frankenstein. I always check on the names because a lot of the times the names won't match up to what they have in Letterboxd and in the movie database. A lot of these movies have alternate titles. So this time, we saw Santo go against Dracula's, Frankenstein's daughter, but now he's going against Frankenstein, Dr. Frankenstein himself. That's right. Or I think he's an ancestor, whatever the hell. There's no relation or correlation to the stories. It's just kind of Santo's there. He's a hero, wrestler, badass, does whatever. Him and Blue Demon get involved with this Dr. Frankenstein type because there's these women disappearing in the area. And basically, this Dr. Frankenstein is trying to save his wife, Dr. Five style, but he's trying to figure out these experiments to do a brain transplant. So he'll do a lot of these brain transplants, but nobody will survive. There's absolutely some hilarious lines in this movie. Somebody says, "Why are you taking the trouble to do a brain transplant if they're both dead anyways and sending them out just like because he does this weird thing where they can walk a little bit and like function a little bit?" He's like, "To show chaos in the world and it's frighten everyone." Like, you're just like, oh my god, it's so funny, so nail on the head, like, kind of hear this kind of shit. Like, the dialogue in this one is absolutely priceless and comedic gold. But Dr. Frankenstein has this like zombie golem who's this big monstrous guy that like ends up like just, he's indestructible. He takes bullets with the vest, kills a bunch of cops. Anyways, so they want Santo's body because they want his brain to put in one of these giant colossus kind of guys so they can have his athleticism and intelligence along with the strength of the golem type character. So they want these athletes alive, Santo and Blue Demon. So like the bad guys try to kidnap them. Of course they beat them up, but they can't, they're no match for the zombie golem type character. So that's kind of the plot of the movie. Santo and Blue Demon try to save girls and fight goons and avoid this giant guy in the movie. There's absolutely hilarious fucking like write-in that is so stupid, where in the movie basically they want a wrestling match versus like this big hulking guy. They want Santo to face off against the zombie golem guy, and he's black. So at one point they're like, the bad guys are like, "Well, we want him to face off against Santo in the ring. That's the only way he will, but he'll," and then somebody's like, "But he'll know because his color." So like, we have to dye him. So then it cuts to Santo wrestling this clearly not the same guy, like his build's not nothing. And you're just like, fuck off. That's so silly. That's so ridiculous. But it's a Santo movie, and you get what you get. It's enjoyable. I liked it, but I have to point out those kind of things. This one looked really solid for in comparison to some of the earlier discs that there were. I thought that the last two discs are by far better in picture quality, and that's probably due to elements and stuff like that, and authoring is just a little bit better and everything. So that's Santo and Blue Demon versus Dr. Frankenstein. Okay, the next one, the last one in the Santo set is crazy as well. And this is Santo and Mentekilla Naples in The Revenge of La Llorona. So this is really bizarre. So you know how like they used to have the old Scooby-Doo episodes where they'd pair, like team up with people? So it's like, this time it's Batman and Robin. Next week it's the Harlem Globetrotters. And remember that series? So like Santo does that. Like he has Blue Demon a lot of the times, but I guess apparently he has other people pop up too. So this guy is a famous, like he was a welterweight or something, boxer in Mexico, which is crazy. And I guess at one point, like, boxing was, like, banned or whatever. So literally, Santo and this boxer are running around trying to stop La Llorona. You know, from the movies like Curse of La Llorona, all that stuff, right? The old kind of Mexican legend. What? So they need a medallion to stop her. The one thing I will say, I don't have too much to say about this one. It's rather goofy and silly, but La Llorona looks really creepy. You like can tell it's just kind of a mask and everything like that, but the way they do the makeup and everything like that, I think she looks creepy. I think she looks scary. I think it's kind of cool that Santo's going to face off against a ghost. It also has a little bit more gothic elements than some of the other Santo movies, you know, like tombs and kind of a spooky kind of element. Although it does feel like a lot of the stuff is kind of comedic when, like, they're getting scared. I think only when it comes to the boxer. This one probably left the least impression on me in comparison to this and Dr. Frankenstein, but I did not dislike it. If I had to rank the Santo movies, like all eight of these in this set, this would be difficult, to be honest. I would probably put them in tiers, to be honest. Like, first tier, Santo and the Riders of Terror. Also, probably Santo and Blue Demon versus Dr. Frankenstein. Santo, Frankenstein's Daughter. Santo, Wax Museum. And Santo, Blue Demon versus Dracula and the Wolfman. Those four, I think, are a little bit better. And I would put Revenge of La Llorona. Then I probably would go with the Wax Museum, which I did enjoy. And the bottom two would be Santo and the Vengeance of the Mummy and Santo and the Treasure of Dracula. And the Treasure of Dracula is only near the bottom because it's the clothed version. The unclothed version was so much better. So I knew what I was missing in it. And I'm just like, man, I'm missing all like the naughty bits and shit. And you can pick that version up separate. So anyways, this is a cool, fun set. I learned a lot about Santo and I'd like to see some more Santo. And I'd like to see the one from 1970 where he basically fights the entire Universal Monsters and a golem with Blue Demon. That was a lot of fun. And an evil Blue Demon, too. So there we go. Santo, the Silver Mask, 8-film collection, ranging from movies from 1963 all the way to 1974. All relatively short films. Every single one of them is under 93 minutes. So the one's 97. A little long pushing it on that one. But relatively short films. Nothing too long. But anyways, if you're interested in Santo movies and you want to have some fun, check them out from VCI Entertainment. Okay, the next one up, we are actually covering on the 22 Shots, and this was the only one of the weekly show that we're doing Monday that I hadn't covered on the show, and this is Excision by Ricky Bates Jr. I love Ricky Bates Jr. He made my top 50 favorite horror directors. He has stuff like Trash Fire, Suburban Gothic, and of course, Tone Deaf are like his three, and then of course, Excision. Excision was his debut directed film in 2012. Who's the lead actress in here? I make sure I want to get her. Anna Lynn McCord. Sorry about that. We also have Tracy Lords, April Winter, Roger Bart, Jeremy Sumner. But we also have a lot of great cameos. They're all down at the bottom here. Matthew Gray Gruber, who's in all of Ricky Bates Jr.'s movies. John Waters, he's in a couple. Malcolm McDowell. Ray Wise is in here. So it's got a really great cast. Anyways, this is one of these kind of bizarre movies where we follow like a strange character, like a outcast, you know, weird kind of girl, doesn't really fit in anywhere. And you kind of follow her, you get into her psychology. And at first it feels like kind of this awkward coming of age, silly movie with like weird moments of her kind of hallucinating violence and everything. She has an infatuation with surgery. She believes she's going to be a surgeon, but you know, she's kind of delusional. She's kind of a screw up. She doesn't fit in anywhere. No one really likes her. And her performance is absolutely phenomenal. Like, and you could tell, like, I know that a lot. I remember back in the day, I read this review of The Swimmer with Burt Lancaster, and people said, you know, this guy is such a good actor. Just look at his posture throughout the movie. At first, he starts really broad and big, and like, by the time the end of the movie, he's just broken. He's hunched over. He looks 50 years older, they said. And in this movie, like, her posture, her hunched over, hunched kind of back, and just the way she stands, just her posture alone, like, gives you everything you need to know about this character before she opens her mouth and says anything. The makeup helps and all this stuff. They make her look kind of weird and everything, but like the thick eyebrows and the acne, and it's just teenager at times, but the hunched over posture is just wonderful. It really helps with the character's kind of deal there. So like I was really impressed with it. I have always liked this movie, and it's been a while since I watched it, so when I put it in, like, sometimes you never know if stuff's going to hold up like it used to, and I loved it just as much. So I like a lot of the performances in here. Like, there's a thing that they do a lot of times with, like, kind of the movies from this time frame, like, even before, like, May, or there's another one we're going to cover for the show, Alice Kills, where, like, the main character has some psychological issues, but everyone around them seems also weird and zany and goofy, and it's like everybody is just off in this kind of weird world. And they do those movies too without kind of a horror spin. Like if you look at Chub Scrubber or what was the other one, 50 Pills. There's a lot of these kind of weird, kind of like indie, kind of somewhat comedies, and it feels like it's starting off like that. It really does. And then by the time we get there, like at the end of the movie, it's just a gut wrenching, heartbreaking stuff. I really like this movie. I think it's really well acted. I think it's funny. I think it's darkly humorous. I think it's tragic. It really plays like a genuine tragedy here. But there's some pretty gnarly stuff in here. here as far as like the special effects are concerned, like going forward. There's a lot of like just absolutely hilarious moments of awkwardness, and Ricky Bates is the king of awkward humor. Like in Tone Deaf, there's moments that I laugh out loud with the interactions between the main character Robert Patrick. Same thing with Suburban Gothic, and just he gives these characters these awkward real life moments that are just absolutely priceless, and at times you're cringing but you're laughing, and also you don't really know whether to laugh or cry, and it's all just a really well done aspect in that way. He does it very well, and I love his, the guy's got a direct, you know, link to my funny bone, even if his movies are disturbing and bothersome. Like I said, a lot of times if you can make someone laugh, you can usually get them to cry too in films, as far as my life goes. But anyways, Excision, like, super well acted, well shot too, like, and the performance in the character of McCord, when she goes from her hallucinations to her actual, you know, like real life, the difference in her and her everything like that. You could see her actual delusions of grandeur in her hallucinations, and you could see those coming into the real world at the end of the film in the most tragic sense. Tracy Lords is really a really strong performance in this movie, because she's like the mother who's the strong, but she's a little overdoing it to an extreme extent where you're like, she is so ruthless, but then like she just has a lot to deal with because their other daughter besides McCord is suffering from an illness, and it's just like also the bond between McCord and the younger sister is really heartfelt and touching, and it's a great movie with a lot of really inappropriate yet hilarious dark humor that I love. Like when you look at something like Excision, like I would feel like it's cut from the same cloth as something like Heathers, if that makes any sense, and I mean that as a utmost compliment, and I know Jeremy would be very happy that I'm giving Heathers some love when he's not here. But anyways, Excision, really highly recommended, and I don't know if it's Ricky Bates Jr.'s best movie. I think it may be, but it's my favorite. I love Suburban Gothic and Tone Deaf and Trash Fire as well. But I think this one still is the best and the most impactful for me. So, yeah. Okay, this next one is the Patreon pick, and this is a Jim Simon pick. And he picked The Laughing Policeman with Walter Matthau and Bruce Dern from 1973, directed by Stuart Rosenberg, who directed Cool Hand Luke and The Amityville Horror. So a very capable, great director. So this movie opens up, it's a 70s film, and it just opens up in the most gritty, crazy way. So there's a bus driving, somebody gets on the bus, you see all these people on the bus, different backgrounds, different kind of people, all sorts, and somebody opens fire and literally shoots 8 people on the bus in graphic detail, and it's just bothersome. It's filmed like, I don't know how realistic, I've never seen 8 people get shot on a bus, but it felt real. The hits felt really rough, and just bothersome. Bothersome as hell. Character walks off the bus, you don't ever get a good look at them, they're gone. So then basically what we have here is a group of cops, all different kinds of cops, including Walter Matthau, Bruce Dern, Lou Gossett Jr. There's some other familiar faces in here too, all looking around. There are a lot of character actors that you know. You might not know their names, but you're like, I know that guy. Or they always play a cop. Here they are. And these guys are kind of all around the crime scene. They're talking amongst each other. They all have kind of their own different approach. And then it comes to find out somebody on that bus was actually a police officer as well as Walter Matthau's brother. His partner. So that complicates things. No one really knows exactly what the hell's going on. And then that kind of forms that Walter Matthau and Bruce Dern are kind of, Bruce Dern's kind of his new partner, and Bruce Dern's a little kind of a, you know what, it's weird. Like in the 70s, characters weren't always painted like, you know, black and white. So Bruce Dern's got a lot of rough edges around him in this movie. I mean, Bruce Dern and Walter Matthau are both phenomenal actors. They're like top of the tops. So like they both got some rough edges about them, like especially Bruce Dern. Like he does stuff when he's paired up with other people and you're just like, geez, man, what are you doing? You're really fucking up like a lot of these people's connections with the, you know, their neighborhoods and society and shit like that. Now remember, this is made in 1973. These are cops, and it feels like one of these movies, it's based off a book, but it feels like one of these movies where they actually had real cops come in and give them some pointers and shit. So like you hear cops like refer to, you know, like some kind of like inappropriate, like the race stuff and like homophobia and everything. So like that's there. But you really kind of expect to hear it in this kind of movie or this kind of time. Walter Matthau is just such a fucking sourpuss in this movie, but his performance is great. He just seems lost. And as like a lot of the movie is just these cops going around, including Lou Gossett Jr., and it leads to one of the brilliant lines in 70s lines I've ever heard. I literally rewound it and I laughed hysterically, rewound it, and watched it again. And basically, I'll just give you the line, and when you get to the scene, you'll know what the part is. whatever you're reaching for, it better be a sandwich because you're going to eat it. I was like, oh my God, yes. It's such a brilliant, I laughed out loud. I loved it. Lou Gossett Jr. is really strong in this movie too, you know, so like it's got a great cast. And all the acting is perfect. Like, I'm just saying, like, everybody is really strong. I am a fan of Bruce Dern. I don't know how you could watch a lot of movies and not be a fan of Bruce Dern, to be honest. He's in everything, and he's always great. Yeah, but this movie, literally, they start to dig deeper, investigating all the people on the bus who are murdered, and it starts to lead to an old case that Walter Matthau was a part of that he couldn't just let go. Now, like, you're starting to wonder, is this, like, tunnel vision or something, like, along those lines where that partner was involved, or is it something actually related? And anyways, the climax involves another bus. It's a really great scene. It's really intense. You don't know how it's going to turn out. Just a great movie. Super well acted. Super. It just grabbed me. It grabbed me in. It sucked me in, and I was in the movie the whole entire time. I loved it. Super well acted. Gritty 70s. 70s city life at its finest. Excellently well acted. Well written. Good action too. Gritty action too. And like they have this police raid of this guy who looks like he's in all this military fatigues, and it's just really kind of like off, like the when people die, it's off-putting. It feels really unsettling, as it should really in movies. If you're trying to prove a point, you're not. It probably should be on off-putting and stuff. But The Laughing Policeman, Jim Simon picked this one. It's directed by Stuart Rosenberg, and I was very impressed with it. Of course, you know, like I said, he did Amityville Horror and Cool Hand Luke, so he's a very capable director. This one I liked quite a bit. I put it above Amityville Horror. I know people don't want to hear that, but I would. Yeah, that is The Laughing Policeman. Okay, now we're gonna start an SOV block here. And yeah, I definitely picked this bad boy up. This is probably my favorite SOV movie ever made. This is a movie that I watched dozens of times. It's a movie that I always showed my friends. It's a movie I saw in my teenage years, young teenage, preteen years, and it's been with me ever since. This is 1997's Bloodletting by Matthew Jason Walsh, produced by Tempe Pictures, you know, like J.R. Brookwalter and everything like that. Yeah, this stars James L. Edwards, Anita Albright, a bunch of other kind of Tempe familiars. It also has a lot of people from the indie scene at the time, including Scooter McCrane, Tina Krause, the guy who directed Psycho Sisters is in here as a small role. So you got a lot of kind of familiar faces from the indie shot on video kind of scene at the time. Anyways, this is a great movie. So I remember back in the day in the like review books I'd always read, it said Natural Born Killers Done Right. And they actually gave it a good review, and it was one of these like mainstream books. So like a low budget movie that I enjoyed seeing that in there, I was like, yeah, it justifies me liking this because you're young and like all your friends are like, that stuff sucks. It's like so cheap. And you're just like, it's great. You're crazy. And then you just acquired taste. You know, they don't understand. Anyways, Bloodletting follows the story of this girl has a reason to seek out this serial killer, Butch Harlow. She finds him and blackmails him into teaching her how to kill. So essentially what follows is this twisted, fucked up love story where the two are going on this killing spree, starting with some people that, you know, they want to pick out, and then just kind of going crazy. And like two very people that are not exactly right. You know, the relationships is not going to end exactly great either. So yeah, there's a lot of crazy scenes. The movie's fast paced. I feel like the movie doesn't really let up. It has a lot of, you know, great like moments and everything. And it just keeps going. Like I never like feel like there's any downtime for me personally. But so anyways, like the murders in here are pretty well done. Like, I mean, it's a low budget movie, but I think they're effective. They go places that some other movies I don't think would go, when a family is murdered and everything like that. Also the movie is really fucking funny. Like the dialogue between Butch and Serena is priceless. And James L. Edwards has that kind of, essentially that kind of sarcastic, almost kind of energy about him. He's in a lot of Tempe movies. He's in Polymorph. He's actually become a director himself. He's done Brimstone Incorporated and Her Name Was Krista. So, and he stars in those movies, has roles in those movies as well. So like the dude was one of the Tempe regulars, and Albright is in Polymorph as well, I believe. It's been a while since I watched Polymorph. So it's got like these two have a good chemistry. They go back and forth and everything like that. This is a movie that's been like embedded in my head, so I don't really know that much to say about it except gushing over scene to scene. I think the ending's pretty beautiful. I really enjoy the ending. I think it's quite good. I think there's, like I said, a lot of funny dialogue. This movie is very quotable. Like, you're jogging and you got a joint on you? What is this, the Jane Fonda health program? Just lots of good stuff like that. The scene where basically James L. Edwards meets a group of like people that pick him up in the video store to kind of chat and bullshit is just a wonderful scene in here. Like as far as the special features are concerned on the disc, they because you're like shot on video, what the fuck could they make to make a shot on video look better? But they actually ended up here to source best available standard definition masters encoded with high quality H.264 picture and DTS HD master audio. So yeah. And no material has been upscaled to HD. Anyways, the movie itself, like, it looks a lot better than what I remember on DVD and VHS. But like, the sound really, literally pops in here because J.R. Buchalter, I think, does like all remixes all these, so like all the sounds work and everything. Like the surround sound really comes through, so it's not like a cheap sound or anything like that. And this is like, I want to make sure I give a shout out to the actor who played Rupert. He did pass away, but I'm not doing it because he just passed away. I mean, as I probably would, but his performance I thought was always one of the strongest in the movie. Like his interactions really great. He's got that whole wife beater trailer trash thing down to a T, and he's perfect in the movie. He kind of is doing a Tom Tolles kind of element. I love Tom Tolles and Henry. He kind of is doing that kind of deal, but he's just great in it. I like the new cover art as well. Good stuff. As far as the new features, there are new features which I should get into as well. 2022 audio commentary, James L. Edwards and executive producer J.R. Buchalter, and it's moderated by Tempe historian Ross Snyder of Saturn's Core Audio and Video. This guy knows a fucking lot. There's a scene in this movie where they show like a bunch of VHSs and everything like that, and like I'm pointing out, finally you could see them. Now it's like remastered, it looks great. I'm like pointing out, I was like, oh, I had that one, I had that one, and there's a couple. I'm like, oh, I don't remember Galactic Ninjas. What the fuck is that? Like he's pointing, he's like, oh, I bought that one off you guys. So like, just it's a nice, commentary on there and pointing out where the actors are, get into some of the details about the movie. And we have the old commentary with the director and Matthew Jason Walsh, who actually was an actor before City of the Vampires, which I covered on here, and also has Ariana Albright. I actually never really know. It's Ariuna. Like it's how it's spelled, but I always feel like it's got to be Ariana, and I've been watching her movies forever. I just fucking always mispronounce names anyways, but Albright, James L. Edwards. Then we have 25 Years of Bloodletting. The cast remembers, and it's 18 minutes. That was really fun. It has some of the B movie players in here bringing it up, and they seem a lot of them seem to have fondness of it. James Earl Edwards is pretty candid about it, talking about, you know, originally he was approached to do this movie because he was going to essentially play a version of himself and just be a serial killer version of himself. And he's like, kind of ego. I feel like a lot of ego's got in the way of this movie being better, or not better, but necessarily, you know, himself, just kind of like a little doubt on himself for how he acted and everything like that. Then we have 2021 location tours, which I really like seeing. That's pretty quick though. It's just kind of going into certain areas like a beat down house and everything like that. It's only 4 minutes, but I liked it. Building a Better Bloodletting. This is a 1997 original VHS. Oh yeah. So that's deleted scenes. Building a behind the scenes. Where am I at? I lost my spot. Building a Bloodletting extended cut. So yeah, like all this kind of stuff. I believe that is actually the original kind of making of. So they imported all that stuff. We also have the original VHS version. If you're kind of like, there's a couple adjustments that J.R. Buchalter made, like an insert or something along those lines, and stuff like that. But not much changed. It's not like George Lucas the motherfucking movie where he changed absolutely everything. So you can watch it with the original version as well. They also do throw in a DVD with it. Like they threw in an original Bloodletting DVD. This is actually the soundtrack, but they do have a DVD as well with when you order it, which will include the I've Killed Before original short. This is based off by Matthew Jason Walsh. Anyways, I am very happy to finally have this bad boy on Blu-ray. The only two that I really need now are Polymorph and Sandman, because this Makeflix has put out a lot of the old Tempe catalog. I mean, we've already had Skinned Alive, Robot Ninja, Dead Next Door, Ozone have all got Blu-ray releases, and all the SOB six pack, which is like six movies they made in like a 6 month period or something. It's shorter than that, like a six week period. I don't fucking know. They were made back to back super fast. Anyways, Bloodletting. Love this movie. Love the soundtrack. Love the score. Everything like that. It's one of these movies that I have an affinity for due to being young and liking it too, but also because it's a genuinely really great SOB movie with lots of great comedy and gore and just some fun to it, although it is kind of twisted and screwed up all at the same time, which I like. Also, they do mention in the commentary kind of having an inspiration. I think that James L. Edwards mentions like really liking like stuff like Psychos in Love, which I absolutely love as well, but I believes the director actually didn't like that movie. He's like, but I don't understand how, connectivity, whatever. Anyways, yeah, really cool cover art on this bad boy. I'm glad to see these movies getting Blu-rays. And I was, when they first started doing SOVs on Blu-rays, I was like, what? But when you look at the difference between this and DVD, there is a substantial difference. So, yeah. Anyways, Bloodletting, you can rent it on Vimeo. If you don't want to buy the disc, you can buy the Blu-ray at makeflix.com. Yeah, check it out. I'm sure you'll enjoy it, especially if you like SOV from that time period. I would recommend it. I think this is one of the best that it has to offer, along with stuff like Shattered Dead and Savage Harvest and stuff like that, and some other Tempe classics like Ozone. Yeah, good stuff. Okay, this next one here is from SOV Horror, and this is Writer's Block, Truth or Dare Part 2. And you're like, wait a minute, Dave, isn't Wicked Games Truth or Dare Part 2 by Tim Ritter? And yeah, it is. So this is weird. This is an unofficial sequel to Truth or Dare. Yeah, so anyways, this basically, it opens up with a kind of a messed up character murdering, like, or going nuts and killing his family. He's just obviously unstable. You're not really sure if that's like a hallucination or whatever the hell, you understand that this character is unstable. Then we kind of cut to this writer who just wrote a book that's getting decent praise and everything like that, but he's struggling writing his next one. He's got writer's block, so he ends up finding this box in his house, and he's like, what the hell is this? And it turns out it's like this story written by that crazy person that we saw in the very beginning. He realizes he can make it work, Truth or Dare. Book's called. He takes it, he publishes it, it becomes a huge hit. And guess what? That person finds out and starts to stalk him and harass him and call him. Like, it does have some stuff like Misery, kind of like book signings and stuff. And like, just you get that kind of element too. Like, it feels like, yeah, that little element. But that's a little bit different, of course. But anyways, this character starts to kind of stalk him and make his life a living hell. And of course, some people are going to be murdered because it's an SOV kind of horror style thing. On the disc, there's a really great interview, like an audio interview with Tim Ritter talking about how this movie got made. And I absolutely loved it. I thought it was fairly well. It was really interesting to hear that kind of stuff, because this was put out by Dead Alive Pictures, as was Wicked Games. And Wicked Games was initially made as Truth or Dare 2 because the title with the Madonna movie and all that kind of shit was messed up. So they decided to call Truth or Dare 2 Wicked Games, and they continued the story. So Dead Alive Productions is like, hey, we want Truth or Dare 2. He's like, yeah, I gave you Truth or Dare 2. It's Wicked Games. And he's like, you're like, yeah, that's selling really well. We're happy about it, but we want Truth or Dare 2. He's like, I don't understand what's going on. Like, so basically they went ahead and made this unauthorized sequel to Truth or Dare because they liked that title. That title did well at the stores or something along those lines. And that's how Truth or Dare Writer's Block Truth or Dare 2 became. Yeah. So the movie, I enjoyed this one more than the last SOV horror I watched, Mr. Ice Cream Man. I thought that it was a little bit better put together, if that makes any sense, just as far as the acting is concerned, because I mean, the other one had a lot of child actors. I thought the acting in this one was fairly solid. I thought the guy who played the killer was pretty damn creepy, actually. I thought his performance was really effective, and I like the idea of stealing someone's work and someone coming after you. Yeah, so like, I don't have too much to say about it as far as that is concerned. Like I said, the story behind the movie is actually more interesting than the movie, but the movie is actually an entertaining piece of as well. Like, I find it very funny, to be honest, that there is two Truth or Dare 2s, and I didn't know about this one. If I did, I completely forgot about it. Anyways, but there's like lots of good scenes with the writer, like talking to other people who come to get his book signing, and they're like, we love Truth or Dare, we love Truth or Dare. And he's like, well, what about my first book? Do you like that one? Like, that one's good, but we can't wait to get more Truth or Dare shit. And he's just like, obviously upset about it. And like, it starts like the way it is, it plays a lot like kind of like a 90s thriller too, like where the character's like behind the scenes, like screwing up his life. So his wife thinks he's possibly cheating on him, all that kind of shit, until it, you know, escalates into like murder and everything. And he's coming after them. And obviously they have to defend themselves. But yeah, this one's decent. I thought it was pretty good, especially for an SOV movie. You never know the quality. Sometimes like, yeah, this one was made for the VHS market and it was made to make money, but I enjoyed it quite a bit. You never know. Like, I actually had people that seemed to give a shit when they made the movie, and that helps. As far as the special features are concerned, we have audio commentary with director Chris Lamont, audio interview with Truth or Dare director Tim Ritter, new director's cut version of Writer's Block, the trailer, SOVhorror.com trailer vault. So anyways, check out SOV Horror. If it's this one sounds like it's up your alley, they have like 50 titles to choose from. I would recommend picking up like Metal Noir or something like that, or Spirit Gallery. Those are pretty interesting movies, and they have some other ones including Writer's Block that you might enjoy as well. So yeah, check it out. Okay, guys, we're going to hop into those 1994 movies.
Prison officials say Dahmer's head may have been bashed against a wall.
A day of last-minute appeals failed to stop the execution of America's most notorious mass murderer, John Wayne Gacy.
Throughout, Chikatilo presented himself as a wretched victim of nature's indifference.
Satan approves.
Reality! What do you know about reality?
It's not a Sutter Kane story. This is not reality. Not reality. Not reality.
This is reality.
The delusion of a disordered mind. A phantom. A spirit. A ghost.
Look, he hasn't got any relatives, and the coma he's in is irreversible. Give me a signature and I'll pull the plug now!
Fuck off!
And the first one up is the Tim Ritter classic. Since I covered Truth or Dare 2 Writer's Block, why not cover the real Truth or Dare for 1994? And that is Wicked Games by Tim Ritter. This is a sequel to Truth or Dare from 1986, I believe. This was made in 94, like I said. Was Truth or Dare 86 or was it a little later than that? Anyways, if you guys don't know this one, it's been a while since I've watched this one. I had the Blu-ray. And I completely forgot, so I started watching the old SRS DVD, and I was like, wait a minute, don't I have the Blu-ray? There's a Blu-ray, and I was like, son of a bitch. So I ended up popping on the Blu-ray and watching a little bit of that, too. So the original version was made in 94, but there has been a re-edited a weird version in 2004 called the Snuff Edition, which adds more violence and ends on a more downbeat level. So, okay, as far as SOVs are concerned, Tim Ritter made some really solid ones. Wicked Games, I really enjoyed. So it stars Joel D. Weinkoop, who's been in about 100 B-movies. I always enjoy Joel D. Weinkoop. He's got a lot of energies, a lot of charisma. He's a very fun actor. So this one is bonkers. This one is like kind of Florida exploitation at its finest. So basically, if anybody knows the first movie, there was a guy who basically caught his wife cheating on him, and he snapped, and he put on this copper mask after he disfigured his face, went to a mental institution. He escaped, put on the copper mask, and started massacring a bunch of people. He goes on a killing spree, essentially, which is also a name of another Tim Ritter movie, Killing Spree. So what happens is this one, Mike Stauber is in the Sunnyvale mental institution. He's not really a player in this movie or anything like that, but there is a killer going around picking off people. And it seems that the killer has a focus. He seems to be picking on people that are committing infidelity, which is kind of what the main killer did in Truth or Dare. Essentially, is his catalyst for the murders. At the same time, basically these murders start after a private eye catches his wife cheating on him. So his friend, who's played by Detective Dan Hess, is it Dan Hess? Is that the next movie? Basically, Joel D. Weinkoop's character is essentially his best friend. He's a cop, so he starts living with him. But Joel D. Weinkoop starts to suspect that, you know, these murders are probably being committed by someone who's been upset by this kind of thing in the past. And guess what? Gary, who's the private eye, was cousins with Mike Stauber from the original Truth or Dare. So, oh shit. Also, in this film, we have this bizarre doctor character who works at the institution. And, like, you start to realize as the movie goes on that Joel D. Weinkoop, Gary, and this doctor are all kind of fucked up. And you're like, man, like, you see the Copper Mask Killer picking people off, and, like, you know who's playing the Copper Mask Killer under the mask, but that wouldn't be above an SOV to pull a fast one on you. So you're like, I wonder who really is the killer in this one. Like, rewatching it, I remembered the ending of this one. I've always really dug the ending. So, basically, a lot of the time, it's these, like, a lot of these kind of like sleazy characters. Almost every guy in this movie is this trash bag. Like they'll be like making out, or like the guy will want to push it further, and she's like no. And then, like, of course, the Copper Mask Killer comes out and kills him. And, like, a lot of that is happening here. Like, a lot of prostitution, a lot of sleaze, all that kind of stuff. And, like, it shows, you start to, as it goes on, you get, like, more insight on some of these characters. And the end reveal, you're like, oh, that makes a lot of sense, like, as what's going on. And then there's kind of like a double ending where you're like, well, all the plot holes that you possibly had in the movie are kind of fixed with that. And I really enjoyed that. So, like, I am a big kind of Joel D. Weinkoop fan, so that, like, helps me enjoy this movie. But I'm just saying it is a very enjoyable SOV on top of that. Like, there's, like, you know, acting ranges in a lot of these movies. But I think the dialogue for SOV in this one is fairly solid. You know what I mean? Like, you think some of the SOV movies you have seen, and you're like, they're not even trying with dialogue here. I think some of the dialogue is pretty solid. And there's some really kind of twisted gore effects, somebody committing suicide somewhat, and that's a great scene, and everything like that. So there's a lot of cool shit going on, a lot of gore and innovative kills, too, almost silly to the point of over-the-topness, like somebody being killed with a beer can or a sprinkler, just shit like that, where you're like, this is clearly kind of tongue-in-the-cheek with the kills that way. And they incorporate a fair amount of nudity. It's much sleazier than the first Truth or Dare movie or Killing Spree. So it's like our I think Creep is sleazier, but I think Creep came actually after this in 95. So anyways, I think this one's pretty solid. And the Snuff Edition is really bizarre. I put that on for a while, and I hadn't watched the Snuff Edition in a long time. And it opens up with, like, the big ending reveal, and the ending is completely different and everything like that. And I do like the ending, too. All my Letterboxd review is, what do you think we should do now? And, like, the ending is just kind of cool. And anyways, like, I don't want to, like, keep talking about it and spoil the complete ending or anything like that. But I know a lot of people will find, like, some unintentional humor, just some funny stuff in there too, like when he breaks the bottle over the guy cheating on his wife's head, and he's like, get a life, Gary, and he's just like, bam, or he's like, yeah, get a life, and he just breaks the bottle over his head. I always like that. But yeah, this is the old DVD edition, which only has like a little making of on there as well. And they do talk about, like, having trouble with, like, the Florida Film Commission and shit, like getting in trouble and shit, filming on a beach without a permit and all that kind of stuff, and Tim Ritter made the news in Florida and everything like that. Yeah, as far as this one is concerned, this Blu-ray, it has some special, it is SOV, so Blu-ray, SOV on Blu-ray, but it has the original cut, then the Snuff Edition cut, a commentary track on that edition, Tim Ritter interview, a photo gallery, and Elijah Wood PR, because if you guys didn't know, Elijah Wood really loves the first Truth or Dare movie, he has a soft spot for it. Anyways, it's kind of cool to see all these SOV movies from 94 that I like we have Shattered Dead, Savage Harvest, Wicked Games, Gore Horror, Sinister, all good, solid SOV movies from 94, like, it was a good time for SOV, to be honest, and weird kind of independent cinema. So yeah, that is Wicked Games. Okay, this is one I've already covered on this channel, and I've seen it a bunch of times, but it's from 94. It's kind of a bigger title from 94. I really just could not cover it again. And this is Brain Scan. That's right, starring Edward Furlong, Frank Langella. Who else? Directed by John Flynn, who has a couple pictures under his belt. This is the Scream Factory edition. And I will mention, there's a lot of good special features on here, because the last time I covered this, I covered the Echo Bridge, or the Mill Creek, which had, like, that Mind Warp on it, and there was kind of bare bones. But we have a new audio commentary, assistant director Tara George Flynn. And that's, like, his son, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, or basically an interview, I believe. New digital debut, an interview with screenwriter Andrew Kevin Walker. He talks about the differences the movie was, and he actually enjoyed the film, which is cool. New Talking with the Trickster, an interview with actor T. Ryder Smith, and the Trickster character in this movie is very memorable, very fun. It's the kind of their take on the Freddy Krueger type, and that guy is definitely very funny and seems like a very down-to-earth guy. Very good actor, too. And then we have New Merging Realities, featuring interviews with special effects supervisor Steve Johnson and special effects artist Andy Schoenberg and Mike Smithson. That's great, because they tell this great story about permits in Canada, and they talk about a deleted piece of the film. That effect is wild when you see it behind the scenes. Steve Johnson always has a lot to say, and also very candid and honest about special effects nowadays. We have a new musical, Virtuosity, interview with composer George S. Clinton. And I will say about this is, Brain Scan has a really great score. It has a wonderful score, and I think that might be the strongest part of the movie. And I liked Brain Scan quite a bit. I was born in 86. I saw this movie young, and I always loved it. Always had a soft spot for it. But the score is absolutely wonderful. And the composer basically hits the nail on the head. He's like, yeah, sometimes I'll put it in and check it out. And he's like, but when that guitar riff hits, bam! And it's just like, yeah, it's good. And I was just like, he's so fucking right. Like, it just hits. It hits. And he's 100% right. And that's the part of the song, like, a lot of times you'll listen to music or watch something and, like, you won't register why you like something so much, but somebody who's directly involved with it or knows a lot more about it will talk about it and say, well, that hit, and you're like, That is exactly why I like that. Thank you for helping me understand. And then we have a deleted scene, which is that crazy special effect, which I thought was great. Behind the scenes footage, teaser trailer, theatrical trailer, TV spot, still gallery. So essentially this is a plot. The plot of Brain Scan is we have this horror-obsessed kid in Edward Furlong. And he loves horror movies. He loves horror video games. He loves all that horror stuff. He's kind of an outcast. He's also a voyeur. He spies on his neighbor across the next door and takes pictures of her and everything like that. Kind of a little perverted. Obviously, not something that would be in a movie nowadays if you wanted that character to be somewhat likable. And in a kind of a typical fashion, his mother died in a car accident. He basically has never got over that, as you wouldn't. He has a limp because of it. And it's just all, you know, a lot of trauma. His father's never around. Think the gate. Remember the father never being around? Dead mother? A lot like that. So we have that kind of element there. So one day he learns about this video game called Brain Scan, which is supposed to be the next in the state-of-the-art video gaming. And basically this game is sent to his house mysteriously. Lots of weird shit happened that they didn't have the technology to happen at the time, but now they probably do. So he gets this game and it basically sends him into committing real-life murder, and he's in the seat. The first murder he commits is fairly graphic, really well done, all point of view stuff here. And then a character comes out of the game when he realizes that he really committed a murder in real life. And it's the trickster, and he's over the top. He's kind of a Maurice from Little Monsters or a Freddy Krueger type, kind of egging him on, and realizes, like, starts to fuck with him. And he's kind of also like kind of like a almost like a part of his consciousness, right? That evil dark side that he's explores and everything like that. So the writer, basically the trickster, TJ Ryder Smith, is basically like kind of pushing him further to play the next disc and next disc. You got to get rid of a witness, you got to do this. And I will say this, the big disappointment about this movie, although it is one of my favorites from the year, I'm not gonna lie, is that there's not enough murders on screen. So, like, I don't want anybody to go into this thinking it's this crazy gore fest or slasher or blood fest or perverse point of view maniac style movie or something like that, the 2012. It's not. It's not that. But I do love this movie, and the first kill is very effective. The only hit I can make on the movie is, I know people are like, that technology, I'm not going to hate on a movie for 94 technology, okay, or what they predicted, because it did come true. It always comes true. But I'm just saying, like, the kills, there should have probably been a couple more kills, but I do love the movie. And anyways, essentially kind of pushes him further, and he's got to cover up witnesses, but there's a cop on his trail, and Frank Langella. And Frank Langella is so good in this. His interactions with Edward Furlong, I love. He's like, in the very beginning, he like witnesses a crime scene that he has nothing to do with, like there's some tape up and everything like that. And he's kind of staring at the car crash. It's a crime, car crash. Looks like somebody died. And they're pulling out stretchers. Whatever the hell happened. And Frank Langella is like, are these people friends of yours? And he's like, no. He's like, then go home. Do your homework. And just like every interaction he has. Like the second time he meets him, he's like at the crime scene that he actually committed. And he's just like, are you following me, kid? And he's like, no, I'm sorry. He's like, nothing to be sorry about, just get out of here. Like, it's just great. He's absolutely, now Frank Langella is an actor that like I know from just a couple things, like Dave, of course. Dave, he's in that. He plays kind of a vice president asshole. And Skeletor in Master Universe. And I know people like, that movie sucks. Like, yeah, it's a terrible Master Universe movie if you're looking at it in a video game, but who gives a fuck considering the whole thing was made off a bunch of toy series. So as far as I'm concerned, that movie is a childhood favorite of mine, and I always loved it. And the thing that still stands great, I know I love everything about it, not everything is great, but you know what? You cannot argue the performance for Frank Langella as Skeletor. It's absolutely wonderful, and he has this great demeanor about him in this movie. I absolutely love him. Like, there's a point when we get that mob mentality, I think like Silver Bullet happens into, where everybody's like running amok trying to find the killer and everything in this neighborhood, this suburban like upper class neighborhood, and somebody gets shot that shouldn't, and his response to them is like, who's gonna tell his wife? And you're like, yeah, that's about the worst punishment you could give to somebody. He's like, hey, I accidentally shot your husband, I'm sorry. Like, fuck, that's bad. But anyways, like I said, it's a great addition. It looks really good. The music hits hard. Love the score. Just one I absolutely loved, and I still love it. And it holds up for me. It's just fun, man. It's comfort food. Edward Furlong's really good into it. This is young Eddie Furlong. Yeah. And this is like right after Terminator 2, I believe, or around that time. Does good job. Enjoy it. Like it. Highly recommend it. If you like that sort of thing. Now, a lot of people aren't going to like this, especially probably people that were already 30, 40 when this movie came out. They'll probably be like, I don't like it. They'll have that get off my lawn mentality, which I do understand, because I get that with newer movies sometimes. And it's just, you got to fight that sometimes. You got to fight your biases and all that kind of shit sometimes. Sometimes you just can't help it. You got to embrace it sometimes. But anyways, Brain Scan, I love it. Very enjoyable. Technological horror. A lot of the special effects and that kind of aspect don't age well, but hey, I still really like this one. Okay, this next one, I'm going to be brief with it, although it is very epic and long, and I probably shouldn't be. This is Lars von Trier, The Kingdom. This is a TV miniseries, and this is like the stuff that came out in 94, I think, was like the first three or four episodes. It's 4 hours and 21 minutes, and then they made the second series in 1997, and I think they actually made a third series more recently. Lars von Trier is a very controversial director. He's made some really wild movies like Nymphomaniac 1 and 2, Antichrist, what else did he, The House That Jack Built. He's done a lot of movies. And The Kingdom, I was very interested in here. And I heard a lot of good things, but this basically follows a Danish hospital called The Kingdom, and they kind of explain how it got that name and everything like that, and there is like some weird spiritualism within the hospital and everything like that, and it follows like a lot of characters. Some of the main ones include Helmer, who is a Swedish, I believe he's a Swedish doctor, and he was kind of, I believe, banned from Sweden practicing, or something weird happened, and he's in Denmark now practicing at this Kingdom hospital, and he is absolutely a miserable prick. He hates everything Danish. He is always bad-mouthing everything about it. He's probably my favorite character. Not the character I like the most, but I love watching him. He's an asshole. He's great. He's just... He's fucking amazing in it. We have like the guy who runs the place who's completely oblivious and kind of just a dullard, honestly, compared to like everybody else. And then we have a guy who's like a young doctor up and coming, clashes heads with Helmer, all these different characters in here. But really, kind of like the main characters are the young doctor, Helmer, and this woman who is constantly in and out of the hospital on purpose because she is... basically, she is a mystical person or whatever. She has these weird kind of... I don't even know how to put it. She's into the occult, and she has this strange religion, and she has all these followers, so she's always comforting them. She's making up these illnesses, yada, yada, yada. Her son is an orderly, so he can kind of... She got to get a little bit away with more on there. And then one day, while she's kind of being like in the hospital, she hears this weird voice in the elevator of a young girl. She becomes infatuated with it, and she thinks the hospital, the kingdom, is haunted. So she goes, digs deeper, and through like the backdrop of like all these, you know, like bureaucracy and medical shit and people fighting and a lot of strange characters doing strange things, including one character who's obsessed with a hematoma and a patient that he wants to study, and another character who is trying to win the love of another colleague, and he plans on taking a corpse's head, all this kind of shit. It basically is this ghost story, and all good ghost stories have a mystery, and you got to figure it out. And we kind of have some people teaming up to figure it out. It all ends in kind of like... an absolutely hilarious kind of last episode, and then it ends on the last scene is actually pretty disturbing. Uday Kier is in here, of course. That's the second Uday Kier movie this week. But anyways, it's just a really interesting, really darkly humorous but disturbing and entertaining ghost story about bureaucracy and just insanity and the hospital, and I really would recommend checking it out. The stuff that happens to Helmer's car keeps coming up and happening again. I love it's just good stuff. I never saw this when it came out. I had like a VHS double tape and I never got a chance to watch it. Like I said, I'll have to track down the 97 and watch that eventually, but 4.5 hours is a lot to dedicate it, but I kind of have to see how this damn thing turns out. I wanted to watch it for 94 because Lars von Trier is such a, you know, a force in filmmaking, and this is such a popular miniseries, and I look at it, you know, with The Stand, I'm going to watch The Stand for 94, I might as well watch The Kingdom. So anyways, The Kingdom, great stuff, really recommended. Check it out if you have the means or anything like that, or if you have the time. 4 hours, 21 minutes, and I think together it's a 9-hour series, and then we have the new one coming out. I don't know how long that bad boy is, but yeah, anyways, good stuff, check it out.
Hey guys, what's up? We're here for You Ain't Seen, and like a typical Dave fashion, I cheated.
Yeah,
I gave you a choice of a 1994 movie I knew you couldn't refuse, and I gave you The Shining, of course, was one of your choices. You didn't pick that one. I don't know why. I always thought you liked Stephen King. But I picked, I put Heavenly Creatures up there. You picked that one, a 94 movie based on a true story, directed by pretty famous director Peter Jackson. He obviously started in his horror roots with stuff like Bad Taste, Meet the Feebles, Dead Alive, kind of more crazy routes, and then eventually he would get to... Heavenly Creatures, which got a lot of, you know, critical response, and then he would do Frighteners, and then eventually the Lord of the Rings films. So Heavenly Creatures I had only seen once, and it probably was going through my Peter Jackson phase when I watched a lot of his early stuff and really liked him. I had heard good things about Heavenly Creatures, so I sought it out. It's never had a stateside Blu-ray or anything like that. No, I think it had a foreign Blu-ray, but I guess... It's not great print or anything like that. I don't think a remastered or anything too well. But as far as Heavenly Creatures is concerned, it's based on a true incident that happened in the 50s, 52, 53, 54, that kind of area, about two girls who have a lot of similarities in this kind of, I don't want to say it's really like a... a place where they're kind of like super conservative or not, but it's the 50s, so everywhere's kind of super conservative and things like that. And they form this friendship based on a lot of fantasy elements and imagination that they have, but there's also like a deep love, and it's not necessarily sexual, although it does eventually become sexual in a lot of ways, but there's a lot of fantastical elements of them imagining the stories that they make and the clay creations that they make coming to life and stuff like that. And you can obviously tell that they have a major disconnect from reality. So Kate Winslet is one of the stars of this movie. She would obviously go on to be in much bigger films and a kind of a household name. Everybody knows that name. Mm-hmm. The other actress I don't know as well. I feel like I don't know her typically. And a lot of the other actors and actresses are all good. Everybody's really solid in the film, but they're not even faces I would typically recognize, maybe besides the mother, looks very much like everybody's mom. And of course there is a little cameo by the mother in Dead Alive.
Yes, yeah,
So yeah, this movie is amazingly well acted, amazingly well shot, just a gut-wrenching experience. And I'm not sure which version we watched. I think initially the original version by Peter Jackson is what I heard is the version he prefers, not the director's cut. And this one's called the uncut version, which is kind of exploitative in a weird way. Like, this isn't the typical movie. It's like uncut. Like, I imagine there, like, it's not an overly violent movie, but there is a scene of violence that is like, it's really impactful because of that.
Right.
And like, it's really, as far as the fantastical elements are concerned, that scene of violence is really grounded, and it's really unpleasant. So we can probably spoil this one if nobody's seen Heavenly Creatures. I think it's a great movie. It's probably his best movie on critical paper, if you look at it, critics paper.
Like, I guess maybe...
You can't compare all his movies. They're so different.
Right. I guess maybe given the subject nature of what's going on here, with it being based on a true story, it might technically be his best movie, yeah. But...
It's not my favorite, but
it's not my personal favorite. I still really like, obviously, Dead Alive and, the Lord of the Rings.
I'm a Dead Alive Meet the Feebles kind of guy myself.
Never seen Meet the Feebles.
Yeah, that should definitely be a pick for you.
Right.
Anyways, I really like this. The performances are great. I would say it is a slow-paced movie, but it's not boring. You're always constantly captivated by what's going on.
Yeah, I don't know if it's like the pacing is slow, because there's always something happening. It takes a very long time to get to where the movie ends up at. Which I didn't know if this was based off a true story, so...
You didn't know until, like, the last 5 minutes.
Right. Yeah, like, I had no idea.
You're like, wait a minute.
So when it's starting to happen, like what's eventually going to happen, I'm like, oh, man, I really don't want this to happen. It actually kind of upset me a little.
It literally, like, the part where the two go out and says to her mom, treat yourself, mom. Like, and she's just, like, deadpan and all fucked up and, like... That part just really, like, hurt my soul in general. That whole, like, scene with the beautiful music, I feel like it's classic music, of them walking and just, like, down the trail. It's just like, oh, man, that's just rough stuff. Like, it's so well done, too. I love how they set up the psychology of the characters. It's so 101. Like, it's like... Oh, I was sick in bed for a long time. And, like, right. You hear so many, like, people that are obsessed with movies, like, oh, I was really sick in bed, so I couldn't do anything, and I basically just sat there and read comics, or I watched movies, and it became my escape from reality. And here they are, escaping from reality amongst each other, and it's just, like, it's just a recipe for disaster that these two would come together, and it's like a beautiful love story, but also a horrible tragedy at the same time. And their sentencing is also, like... As bad the thing that they did, which is unforgivable and heart-wrenching, you're just like, maybe they should get rid of that last thing in their sentencing. Like,
well, you know, like, the weird thing is, like, these two characters, like, you want them to be together. You know, whether it's romantically, platonically, it doesn't matter. Like, you just want them to be together. They're that good of friends, and the people around them are... really trying to break them apart.
For good reason, though. From the outside, it doesn't look good in that day and time.
That's another thing. It's like, you know, this does take place in the 50s. You know, it is a different world back then. But it's not for a good reason. It's for a fucking bullshit reason.
Yeah, but it's the 50s.
It's the 50s. But, you know, so all the more reason why I think I'm rooting for them, to be together.
To overcome the circumstances.
Right, overcome the circumstances. Like, power of love, yada, yada, yada. But then they just fucking go crazy.
Kate Winslet is like a know-it-all. Like, she's a genius. They're both highly intelligent, highly skilled.
like, it's just like they're smarter than everybody around them, too. Right. But they're also highly creative, but also detached from reality. So it's just a fucking recipe, like I said, for disaster.
You know, they're 15 years old, I think, in this. And so, yeah, it's... They're both incredibly intelligent, but they have, like, that emotional capacity of a 15-year-old. You know what I mean? It's just us against the world.
Like, I like how they mix fantasy with reality. Some of the way they use their filming techniques are beautiful. Like, the Orson Welles Third Man stuff when they're chasing them. Mm-hmm. And the lighting and stuff is beautiful and wonderful. And, like, you have the background. It's, like, a bluish, greenish tint. And then, like, they'll have, like, scenes that look like he's black and white, but he's not necessarily in other parts of color. I love how they mix the clay, like, fantasy world that they have.
I love the clay fantasy world they go to.
And then, like, reality and fantasy mix and all that kind of stuff. Like, it's just a really innovative and inventive movie how to recreate their fantastical world and give you a glimpse of what they might have been experiencing. And as bleak as the ending is, I think that it's told from a very sympathetic person, like in Peter Jackson.
Yeah, it really is. I mean, you still end up hating what they do.
I feel like he probably was a lot in this. Like, you know, if you read Stephen King books, which I know you didn't, there's always a character that's bullied. And, like, the bullies are ruthless monsters. You're like, and, like, Stephen King's obviously working some shit out there. And, like, and Peter Jackson's a good person to direct something like this. Del Toro would be as well. Like, they're love.
Right.
Fantastical mixed with reality. This is a very Del Toro movie.
Oh, it absolutely is. You know, I think Peter Jackson and Del Toro, like, they kind of go hand in hand to me.
Certain extent, yeah.
They even worked, is it the first Hobbit? I think they worked
on
together.
That's why that one's the best.
And the, you know, the second, it is the best one.
Turds.
Right.
To me, in comparison to the first one, I'll say. Mm-hmm. But, I think it's a great movie. Like, it's maybe not a personal favorite in comparison to his other films, but it's like one of his best, if not. Like, you can't argue it. I can't. Like, if they were to come at me with what they didn't like about it, it wouldn't be technical shit. It wouldn't be acting stuff. It would probably be in terms of the plot. And I could see some people that know the true story probably being more annoyed with stuff that it's like, oh, that's not how it really happened. But it's just like, well, I never even knew that this happened until the movie. So at the same time, you got to look at it that aspect.
Right, yeah.
The story is partially known. At all is better than not known, right?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe, I don't know.
Maybe.
Who knows? When they do the little thing at the end with telling what happened, it's really sad.
It is sad.
But, like, still not nearly as sad as what happened to the poor mother.
Well, yeah, and the thing with the mom is, like, she is...
The best parent of the four.
Yeah, she is. Of the four parents, I think that she's, like, the most sympathetic. Is like, I think you kind of get where she's coming from.
You understand her.
Right. Is it Kate Winslet?
Yeah.
Like, her parents are...
Kind of shitty.
Yeah, kind of.
Like, travel across... Leave her alone a lot by herself, with her imagination.
Yeah, like, you have the impression that the father's maybe hooked up at some sort of scandal at the university. And
the mother's obviously having an affair. You know what I like? I like the aspect that, like, you have, like, the one girl. They have two different names, too. They go by, like, their names.
Yeah, they have, like, multiple names, yeah.
Yvonne, I believe, goes, like, her family is more the religious, like, working class, grounded family, and they believe in God, while the rich family is, like, you know, sophisticated, and they do not. Like,
right.
But, like, these two share that love between them. Like, you know, they connect a tissue. And, like, I think that my weird gay love story that I picked is much better than your weird gay love story that you picked last week.
No, not at all. They're completely different.
I don't care.
One's a coming-of-age story, finding yourself. The other one's about a murder.
One's that, like, the tabloids probably went nuts about. Right, I'd love to read the tabloids from 1953-54 about this story. It's probably amazing. Just how, like, crazy they are.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and how over the top all the stories are and shit. Like, they bathed in the mother's blood. That never happened. Like, this shit, like, right? The whole time. But, I mean, it's a classic for a reason. It's been years since I had watched it. I'm glad I got to rewatch it. It also fits into 1994. Now, like, is it a horror movie? It's definitely a fantasy movie, but it's the strangest of subgenres mixed. It's a true crime movie. True crime drama.
So it's horror.
It's fantasy. Like, right. It's also a fantasy movie but it's not true fantasy. But what is true fantasy? Is Time Bandits true fantasy? Because you could write it off as, did it really happen? Or Pan's Labyrinth? All that kind of shit. So it's tough, right? Where you put it.
I mean, I would consider it horror, but, you know, I have a very loose definition. Or a very strict definition. I don't know. But, like, a lot of stuff that I think people are on the fence of, I was just like, yeah, it's horror. You know, it's, you know, spooky fantasy stuff. You know, we're good. It's in one of the books.
It's in John Stanley's Creature Features because, you know, it's heavenly creatures. How could you not?
Yeah, I'm just kidding. Yeah.
4 out of 5, a brilliant piece of filmmaking, writing, and acting, conceived with imagination by New Zealand director Peter Jackson and written by Jackson and Francis Walsh, with insight and understanding of teenage behavior. Based on the true life 1954 murder case in New Zealand, this unusual movie depicts two young murderesses to be Kate Winslet and Juliet Marion Hume, and Melanie Lasky. Kate Winslet as Juliet Marion Hume and Melanie Linsky as Pauline Yvonne Parker, in a sympathetic light, and interprets the fourth world in which they escape together as a kind of Oz land where Borovirian creatures, gray clay-like beings, romp around. These special effects characters become substitutes within their individual fantasies as teenagers. Pauline is a door introvert. Kate is an outgoing, precocious, adorable creature. Discover lesbian sex and contemplate eliminating stumbling blocks, such as Pauline's disciplinary mother, for their greater happiness. Unaware of the consequences, the insight into this horrific murder... there's too many parentheses in this review for me to read out loud for people. The teens beat the mother to death with a brick after luring her into Victoria Park, and the use of childlike fantasy images give this film a sensitivity and visual power that lingers on. Pretty dead on review.
Yeah. It was pretty good. I mean, it's definitely a 5-star movie. Like,
I give it 5. Questions asked. Why not? I mean, like, as far as, like, I have a really hard time, like, rating, like, classics or movies that have a really powerful impact, like, anything less, like, the ones that I'm familiar with, too. Like, literally, there was, like, it's one of those deals where I was just, like, that last scene was just, they ended at the right note, too. We didn't see no courtroom shit. It just ended. Just right. Fucking ended. That's what a lot of movies need to do, is just end at the right time.
You know, and I think the characters are all well developed, even like some of the minor ones, like the one flatmate,
John.
Yeah, like everybody's just like, it's just it's a really good, compelling movie.
Yeah.
And then where it ends up, in a completely different direction than what I thought it was going to take, it's like, oh,
you know what, a movie that has a similar ending, like it just ends when it's supposed to end and gives you the credits what happened to the characters.
Hmm.
I feel like Bully. Ends at that, well, that peak moment during the sentencing. I don't know. It just feels like it ends at the right time for me. I don't know if that makes any sense. Like, now, Baby Driver's a great movie that doesn't end at the right time for me.
Right. But whenever you have, like weird, like, crime stuff in a movie, and
you gotta hit at the climax or the emotional.
Yeah, like, how do you, like, deal with, you know, like the very next minute after the movie ends,
don't show it,
right? You know, like I was listening to Heather's today, you know, and like, you know, that movie ends on like, you know, we're not going to kill anyone anymore, but it's like, bro, you just killed like 6 people,
should have blew up the
3 people, yeah. So it's like, how, you know, how does,
if that movie would have blew up the school, it would be even more of a cult item.
It might be. I don't know.
Maybe it would be even more cult. Like,
I mean, it's the only thing. It's the only movie I've ever actually seen.
Stop it.
For one.
We're not doing this right now.
We're not doing it right now.
What are we
now.
Watching next week, Lazy Boy?
You know, I didn't think about what I wanted to watch. I told you yesterday, like, at one point I want to watch Moulin Rouge, so let's just do
Moulin. No, yeah. No, fuck, please don't. I can't watch a 3-hour fucking musical next week.
Yeah, you can.
No, I don't want to, please.
Is it 3 hours long?
I guarantee it's fucking 3 hours long.
It
it's
is a not
musical. I guarantee fucking long. It, man. Please, pick something else.
Well, what do I got to pick? I don't know. I can't think of anything on the...
Why you do this shit?
Well, you know, this
you're
is
supposed
what
to
we're
be fucking
do.
Prepared.
It's either this or Aiken.
I'm always prepared.
Aiken.
Last week I couldn't read Revolution. I'm always prepared. Okay. Don't fucking watch Moulin Rouge. Come on, dude. I'll kill myself.
I mean, that's the goal. I mean,
pick something, please.
You know, he wants to keep dawdling 1994 films.
I'm done with 94.
And Stephen King.
You haven't watched one fucking Stephen King movie.
We watched
You're making
Carrie.
Me fucking watch Moulin Rouge. You pick Carrie, I think.
I did pick
I
Carrie.
Swear I'm picking something stupid as fuck after Moulin Rouge.
I can pick. I can go fall down a rabbit hole.
We're not doing. We're not supposed to be making each other watch movies that suck. I know Moulin Rouge probably doesn't suck, but I fucking, I have no context. You have to take over this entire review.
Well, that's why we have to watch it, so you have the context.
You're right. I'm feeling like a fucking baby. I'll watch anything, right? Talking to a guy who watched fucking Lucifer Valentine.
You watched May for like the 5th time this week.
I have to watch May. Yeah. I didn't have a choice.
Every time you walk into the room,
you have a choice right now.
He's just walking to Peckinpah or May. That was the only two movies
I haven't
he's
watched
ever
a Peckinpah
seen.
In months. I'd like to watch a Peckinpah movie, but I gotta watch fucking Moulin Rouge.
Well, I mean, I can't think of what I want to watch. I mean, I did want to watch Golden Boy, but that's like six episodes. It's no an OVA. TV. It's 30 minutes each episode, nope. 20. But, you know, it's that.
What's Golden Boy?
Well, you know, we'll never watch it because I can't pick
OVA. Okay, sounds great.
Do you want to do Golden Boy?
No.
Oh. You want to do War and Peace?
First part of War and Peace.
You want to do the first part of War and Peace over Moulin Rouge?
It's only the first part of Moulin Rouge. That movie's 7.5 hours, so what?
So we'll have to pick it, like, week after week.
No, we don't.
Yeah, we do. Because we're going to forget.
Moulin Rouge it is.
All right, Moulin Rouge. See you guys next week.
All right, let's get into these questions, answers, whatever. Basically, I asked you guys last week what franchises, if any, get better as they go on. And these are a lot of just comments and everything like that. So, also, I'm not going to try not to read the people like that reply to people that post. Also, like, chill, man. Some people are like, somebody posts something, people that don't even know the person will just like post, like, you're crazy. You're out of fucking, come on. These are their opinions. I'm not trying to argue. They're just answering a question and doing me a favor. So, 81 Oakridge, all these directors trying to make a sequel for one of these franchises should study the Maniac remake. That is a modern-day masterpiece implementing CGI and practical gore effects perfectly. As for Mr. Ice Cream Man, isn't that dude from Nick Palumbo's Nutbag? LOL. I don't think so. I've never actually watched Nutbag, though. So, Phantasm Matt, I died at my son is dead part. God, I need to quote that more now. Haha. The Cannibal Holocaust insert I put. That was always one of my favorite scenes. My son is no good. I do it all the time. Ask anybody. Actually, kind of did that in a movie as a little cameo, if you guys know the movie. I'm not many people probably seen Dino Gore by Seb Godin, but yeah, I have a little cameo in that. And my friend. I don't know if he wants people to know who it is. Basically, just did a little parody of it. Glenn Plain. Hey, Dave. If you're looking for a kind of deep cut from 94, check out Luca Faust, directed by Jan Svachmeier. It's a weird art house Czechoslovakian adaptation of the Faust legend, where a man sells his soul to Lucifer. Not a horror movie per se, but I would say it's a horror adjacent. Lots of crazy stop motion effects and bizarre puppets. A lot of weird sexual stuff. Unsettling atmosphere. Very well made. Can't promise you'll like it. It's weird as hell. But I think you'll find it interesting. I always look forward to your show. Thanks for putting in the work every week for us. Thank you very much. That's a good recommendation. It was on my short list, and I have to admit, like, I watched like 25 minutes of it, and I was like, I have seen, I believe that director did one called Alice, which is the Alice in Wonderland take, and I really enjoyed that when I saw it. But I have had a lot of trouble connecting to Faust. Like, and I the first 20 minutes I was in, but then the next like 20 or so, I was like, I can't. This is losing me. I started just, I don't know. Bad mood or something. I don't know if I'll go back to it. Like, I'm like kind of at the tail end now. I'm close to 90. I'm doing 120, and I have a couple heavy hitters left, but most of it, I don't know. Maybe I'll squeeze it in there. And like, I do appreciate deep cuts. Like, Fella Dad was on my list. I think I planned on it, and then like somebody said you should check that out for sure, and I was like, yeah, I'll push it up, and I'm glad I did. It's great. Ken Coakley, I loved your review of the Texas Chainsaw Massacre reboot. Like you, I went in with no expectations, as I also did with Halloween Kills and with the Evil Dead and Hellraiser reboots. Getting to Texas Chainsaw Massacre, I had a hard time sitting through the first 15 minutes of the movie as I wanted to watch something without a message or use of politics. The beginning of the movie depicted Texans as inbred racist shit-kickers, which, I'm ashamed to admit, was how I prejudged them before my first trip to Houston. When I got there, I met nice people of all walks of life. A timely, the film poked fun at cancel culture, so as a guy who hates censorship, I really like that. I remember when TCM2 came out in 1986. One of the reasons it didn't do well is the fact that it was given an NC-17. Actually, NC-17 didn't exist yet, so it went unrated. But no one under 17 could get in, even with an adult. So it wasn't put in many theaters, like Day of the Dead reanimated the year before. Also, the original film had everyone talking. People who saw it at the drive-in talked about gore that wasn't even there. But everyone, including tough guys, found it terrifying. Then the second one is ready for its limited release, and not only was it 100 times more gory, it was also silly, with Chop Top and Dennis Hopper with the six-gun chainsaws. To top it off, the theatrical poster was a parody of the Breakfast Club theatrical poster. I like the third one for sentimental reasons. Also, R.A. Michael Hoff, and I have met a few times, and he's a really nice guy, as was Gunnar Hansen when I met him. Gunnar was cool, yeah. There will never be another great Texas Chainsaw Massacre piece. Toby Hooper took the legacy with him. You were also right when you said that the certain movies are so special because they were seen with much younger eyes. A lot of people love The Goonies, Sandlot, and others. I was 18 when The Goonies came out and 24 when Home Alone came out. So to sum it up, as you get older, watch these reboots and sequels with a grain of salt.
Even Star Wars isn't good anymore. Yeah, I mean, like, some of that forgiveness and magic within you, it does kind of die at times. And like I said, I really have to just have no expectations for it. I mean, I will tell you what I don't like about a movie and stuff, like a lot of these reboots and everything. I'll tell you what I like about it. But I'll never sit there. I'm never going to tell anybody that New Texas Chainsaw Massacre is a masterpiece. Did I enjoy my time with it? Yeah, I did. So there we go. D. Gulag, love the channel. Agree with you 100% on the TCM stuff. Great breakdown. Thank you. Isamicio, dude, I had to put on the original TCM movie after the 2022 one to wash out the bad taste in my mouth. Shitty thing is, I accept the film for what it is at this point. It's a franchise time in its franchise timeline, but to think it might be included in a franchise box set one day, if that ever happens, hurts my soul. Haha. I need to watch Chocolate Strawberry Vanilla. That's been on my list, but might save it for summertime watches. The Farmer sounds awesome. Art of the Devil is a franchise slash trilogy that gets better with every film. It's the only one I can think of right off the bat. Chris Harper, love Cemetery Man. I always thought Nagi looked like Curly Howard. Wouldn't disagree with that. Jake K and T.E., like your take on TCM and expectations versus reality. Thank you. Mike Moore, gotta get me that Ghost Riders. Looks like fun. Haha. Feel like pretty much all the film series turn into cash crops at some point. They throw a name and a few fan service scenes as a half-assed attempt to make people happy. Everyone has to go see the new fill-in-the-blank. Company makes shit tons of money with little to no chance taken, and most of the films, fans of the original film walk away pissed or disappointed. Same old story. This is why I have little interest in most of the Hollywood films these days. Nothing original. Everything has to be based on source material, part of a series. Great reviews, by the way, Dave. And you know what's funny about that? Like, I know people were always mad about stuff being based off, like, series and stuff, but, like, when I watch 70s stuff, like, everything's based off a book, and they're all fucking great. Maybe they just go back to, like, books that not everybody read. Like, adapt something that's not a Stephen King book for once, right? Why don't we try that? Vintage Web 82, will you be getting the new Project AKO Blu-ray by Discotech Media? It's amazing. Maybe, I'm not sure yet. Tim Hayes, have you reviewed the original Onboard 1991, Roger Corman flick? I noticed you listed as reviewing the sequel in this video, but wasn't sure if you ever covered the original in a video before. Yes, I did. Just search it. It helps with parentheses. If you search Mr. Parker and then put parentheses, the Onboard 1991, it should pop up. Sorry, I need coffee. Funny story. I'm just going to go on a tirade here. I had Friday off because I'm going to film something Saturday. I'm kind of starting a new series. Probably get a couple in the bag before I kind of release them. But Friday I head off, and it was Thursday, and I'm walking into work, and it's dark, and there's, like, you know, big gravel pile because they use the plow and everything to get the snow out of the way. And there's, like, a small walkway, and I kind of look down without paying attention for a minute. I literally trip over the gravel. This is what happens when you're old. And I fucked my knee up. Like, I literally worked half a day and put in half a sick day and left because I'm old and I hurt my knee. I know this has nothing to do with it, but it just kind of pertains to why. Like, I don't know. I just made me think of that for no apparent reason. What did that bring from? Anyways, Ilk Vomit. No, the new CCM was plain dog shit, plain and simple. Old man Leatherface jumping clear out of the water like a superhero was beyond cringe. Hey, and here's what I replied to him, and I basically said, it really doesn't matter at this point because 99% of the reviews or comments are going to be 100% with, like, I absolutely greatest movie ever or worst movie ever with nothing else put into it. So, JT of the Dead, I have been wanting to get some of the Santo and Blue Demon flicks. Also, I really need the Crackdown and Charbrother flicks. Awesome picks, Dave. Thank you. Levy Everhart's Final Destination, basically talking about movies that get better as franchise. Not a single miss, and the last one is arguably the best. And Cameron Sullivan, which is a pattern here. He basically replies to a bunch of people that don't seem to be friends with, arguing with them, or getting mad at their taste and everything. And it's just like, calm down, chill, Cam, chill. He says, part 4 and 5 are dents in the road. I'm just not going to go through this whole thing and everything like that. Argue with people on your own Facebook. I mean, I don't have a problem with arguing or being like, oh, I didn't like that one, but it just seems a little aggressive for Facebook on somebody else's post. Kate Elizabeth, Harry Potter, Alex DaVincio, good call. Mark Humphreys, definitely the Mission Impossible films. Nathan Thomas Minlander, I never watched them, but I hear the Fast and Furious films got better at part 5. I suggest Mission Impossible. Okay. I do hear a lot of good things about the Fast and Furious movies getting better. Never was my cup of tea, so. Jason Hammond, best Fridays are 3, 4, and 5. Dathan Gibson, Zadewichi. Okay, cool. Nut Shannon, Rugai, Evil Dead. Corey Walter, Death Wish movies get better and better to me each sequel. I love all 5 of the Death Wish movies. I like Death Sentence. I don't mind the remake. Corey Zunk, John Wick or Marvel Cinematic Universe. I do think John Wick movies get better. but I think 2 and 3 are about close to me. Salvador Funkenstein, agreed the Friday the 13th got better as Jason became more of a zombie. Don't know if I'd say franchise, but August Underground better with each movie, even if I took forever to see them. Harrison J. Bay, Rise of the Planet of the Apes. Jason Hammond, Leprechaun, and I'll Die on This Hill. Troy Howarth, I can't think of one example where that happened. And Belladonna claps and puts bullseye symbol. So, and it's hard, you know, I mean, sometimes I don't know. I think you start looking at some of the lesser franchises, like some people post Killjoy. That's, I've heard everything about Killjoy, basically getting better as it goes on. Frankie Costello, Toy Story. Brandon Young agrees. Chet Turner, maybe the second Godfather film, but a lot of people disagree. Peter England, as they go on. So you say part three was better than the first two masterpieces, question mark. Mikey Fish, Killjoy actually got better as it went. Peter England, Sergio Leone's Dollar Trilogy. Sebastian Sanjiro Arias, the Psycho franchise. While the original is the best, the sequels are very good. Chris Genro, my favorite franchise. Anthony Perkins was amazing. F the remake. They seem to agree. Aaron Mazzola, John Wick, Peter McCain, Star Wars prequels, actually. Lacey Liu, Bad Boys Trilogy. I would say they were consistent throughout. Madeline Deering, The Purge peaked at 3 for me. I thought it was getting progressively better until the first Purge. Donald Farmer, the Child's Play series peaked with Bride of Chucky. I know people aren't going to like hearing this, but I think 3 is my favorite of the first three, and I think it goes 3-2-1. But hey, I'm kind of on the same page a little bit with Farmer. I haven't watched Bride in years. Michael Darwin, the last three Mission Impossible films are better than the first three. Your Paul Potter. Yeah, that's the one. Cameron Salt. Okay, then we have Lex Crossley. Evil Dead is the closest I can think of. Mark Crosswicks, I believe, how do you say that? Crosswick, The Fast and the Furious, Jack Criddle, The Fast and Furious for sure, Danny Turkel, Mission Impossible. He says Chucky, while the first time Child's Plays are great, Curse and Cult are awesome, and the TV series was even good. Jesse Wright, I think the first three Purge films got better as they went along, and the next two were good as well. Robert Mazzola, maybe Mission Impossible and Die Hard, but definitely debatable. Brandon Cassioli, A Nightmare on Elm Street for me, it got better as it went on, especially the first three. Same with Friday 13th. I have so much fun watching them as they go. Mike Merriman, Friday 1 through 4, arguably got better with each sequel. Even 5 was a fun surprise, all things considered. Jay Ranella, Star Trek. Michael Pickle, Mission Impossible, Donna Farber, most agree that Bride of Frankenstein was even better than the Frankenstein. I hear that a lot. Wouldn't disagree, I don't think. Donald Farmer, I think the James Bond series peaked with the third film, Goldfinger. Sam Kelly Mills, Fast and the Furious, Mission Impossible, Star Trek, Scary Movie. Rich Rabid, Police Academy, Scott Shermer, James Bond. And Cameron Sullivan's got a reply as well. He probably like 10 people. And then when we get to his picks, like, I mean, yeah, if he thinks they're hot takes, but he's got some hot takes too. Don't throw stones. Ron Ford, Mad Max, with the exception of Thunderdome. Jason Lindbergh, as far as all the sequels, etc., better, gotta have to go with 0. Wow. Mark Allen Gunnels, The Purge. Daniel Wendolf, Tough Topic, LOL. I think it is tough, too. Casey Botwin, I can think of so many sequels better than the original, but a series in a whole that got better is hard. Jason O.D., Prom Night. The first one bored me, and then they got awesome. Chris Genro, Skyline, Killjoy, and Silent Night, Deadly Night series. Jordan Bennett, Mission Impossible. Charles Floyd Rhodes, The Seminal Planet of the Apes was high until Battle of the Planet of the Apes, but there was a top-notch reboot trilogy. Star Wars seemed to peak with Empire Strikes Back. Psycho did, but got 2 good theatrical sequels. The Peanuts movies were good, from A Boy Named Charlie Brown to Bon Voyage Charlie Brown. The 4 1970s Pippi movies were consistently good. I like all 4 of the Indiana Jones movies and the original Nightmare on Elm Street movies. Christopher Nolan did a great Batman trilogy. I have no issues with any of the Spider-Man movies, and there are 3 series on that one to boot. And now I think about it, Final Destination also seems to me that Saw and Purge are at least consistent. It's like, I would have listed the Dollar Trilogy if one is technical, it was sold as a series to USA by UA as the Man with No Name series, but the characters have a different name in each one. But for sure, a PB series is a series, but those are books, not movies. Eric Ischelberger, Saw 4. Jason Patrick, Justin Patrick, can't even say my co-host's real name, Killjoy. Camera Raby, I have always thought the Child's Play franchise has delivered the goods, even the brand new TV series, and I'm one of the few who liked the reboot. Then Cameron Sullivan, we get to his. You guys aren't seeing all the replies, I'm not going to read everything. He says, Killjoy, Trancers, Terminator, Blade Runner, Police Academy, Evil Dead, Equalizer, Maniac Cop, Texas Chainsaw, Skyline, Leprechaun, Undisputed, DC, Star Trek, Planet of the Apes, Transformers, Law and Order, Breaking Bad, Purge, Star Wars, thanks to Mandalorian. Yeah, there is some. Like, I would agree with, for sure, with, like, Maniac Cop's a good choice, because 2 is better than 1. I like 3, too. Nick Mua, another difficult question, Monsieur Parker. Most franchises turn to crap as the years go on. I'm going to go with the Alien franchise, excluding the Predator crossover flicks. And when you look at the directors, each of the 4 main films that had, it's not hard to guess why they endured. Hell, let's include Prometheus and an Alien Covenant. Prometheus is a brain teaser, but it feels like an alien. Film. Covenant is mostly okay, even if it suffers from too many characters. Can we say cannon fodder? I also enjoyed all the Hannibal Lecter movies. Would like some fava beans with your Chardonnay, Dave. Okay. Question one: does a crappy sequel spoil what came before for you? Not really. I will lose interest in the series eventually, though. Could you ever watch Dawn of the Dead on a tablet? I've seen Dawn of the Dead so many times, I could watch it on a tablet. I could. And I would just, I wouldn't be against, you know, being somewhere and only being able to listen to it, just listen to the dialogue and music and just quoting along with it and remembering it in my head. So I could watch it on a tablet. But the first time view of a movie that you're supposed to, you think you're going to really like, probably wouldn't want to watch it on a tablet. Though I love the pick of your two snoozing cats, how will they ever get their own spinoff if they're sleeping on the job? I mean, these cats sleep all day. They sleep, they eat, they don't care about no spinoff. David Becker, Resident Evil. Wolf Nards, if Fast and the Furious ended after the seventh movie, Matt Williams, Subspecies, Lance Langford, The Avengers, Kevin Keegan, Art of the Devil series from Thailand, Nathan Padfield, Creepshow TV would be good. Bet, save for three, of course. Pop Culture, Punk, Lethal Weapon, and Up to the Point, the Rocky and Rambo series, Weekend at Bernie's, Death Wish, Up to a Point, and in a sense, Young Guns, Ernest, Friday the 13th, pre-90s, Indiana Jones, pre-4, Vacation, and Father of the Bride, and Angela Jane Nagy, Phantasm. So the question of the week this week is going to be, since we have seen a lot of fan ownership and stuff of like Halloween and Texas Chainsaw, a lot of people and stuff like that. And what is one horror property you think that you may show fan ownership of? Like I am kind of like aware of it. Like I try to stop. Like I get like people get like this weird sense of ownership over a lot of property. Like Star Wars, it'll happen, and you get this crazy fan base. What is one franchise, horror franchise, that you think that you may suffer from thinking you have fan ownership of? Romero's original Dead trilogy, I may be touchy on. Like I won't even watch a Night of the Living Dead remake anymore unless somebody from the original was involved with it. So that's where I'm at on there. So a horror franchise that you feel like you might have fan ownership of, not like you deserve it, but one that you might be like, oh man, I should have some. I feel like I'm just kind of going crazy or just like being inappropriate about this, and it's hard to give fair shakes or and stuff like that, or be blind when you go into it. So yeah, let's hop into the update. Okay, let's hop into this update. First up is the 4K of Alligator. So happy to finally have this on American release. I can finally get rid of or box up my old DVDs from Lionsgate and the Anchor Bay import. Classic movie from 1980, Louis Teague. So yeah, this is a very entertaining flick. If you guys never seen it, it's got three discs in here. You got a television version on Blu-ray, which is awesome. You got it in 4K. Anyways, the classic movie looks like you got some new features on there as well. Robert Forster, great stuff. Next up is from Indicator, their U.S. branch, which are kind of these limited on Amazon. This is The Devil's Men, I believe, a.k.a. Land of the Minotaur, as Donald Pleasance and Peter Cushing. Yeah, never seen this one, although I probably bought it two or three fucking times on DVD. That's just has two versions on there as well and a bunch of features. Then up next, we have Voices with David Hemmings. David Hemmings, I enjoy from Deep Red and some other films as well. Not seen this one. Don't know too much about it. Just sounded very interesting to me, and I've seen a couple David Hemmings thrillers that left an impression on me, so I figured I'd pick this one up as well. I should have put this right after Alligator, but oh well, sorry. Alligator 2 from 1991. Great cover art. Not necessarily a perfect movie or anything like that. Has a couple of fun character actors in here. D. Wallace Stone, Richard Lynch, Steve Rail's back. I used to like this as a kid. It doesn't hold up as much as it used to. So my Vinegar Syndrome order came in as well. We have Corruption. Roger Watkins, if I'm not mistaken here. Yeah, this is, I believe, is the director of Last House on Dead End Street, which is a pretty good flick. Pretty crazy flick, groundbreaking. A lot of people that make kind of extreme films, and they have been an inspiration from that one. Next up, we have Sister Sister, which is this Roberta Finley? No, Eric Stoltz is in it, Jennifer Jason Leigh. It's a movie I'm not too familiar with, to be honest. Sister Sister. So I do the yearly subscription, so looks kind of like in the vein of like a Strange Thriller or something along those lines. Yeah, directed by Bill Condon. It's a familiar name. Ugh. These aren't in order. I should have went all the Vinegar Syndrome ones first. So next up is Drop Dead Fred. That's right, on Blu-ray. Yeah, I remember enjoying this movie. I have not watched it in a long time. It came a little too late to be like a childhood favorite for me. What year was it? I remember I didn't see it. 91. No, I should have. This should have been a childhood favorite for me, but it necessarily. I think I saw a little later, probably like 95 or so. The neighbor really liked this movie. I think she made me watch it. But Rick Miles, great from Bottom, and the Young Ones, and Phoebe Cates. It's just a bizarre, freaking weird movie. If nobody's ever seen it, kind of a cult classic, to be honest. Like, got a cult following for sure. Next up, we have Madman on 4K. Kind of a classic. Like, I wouldn't say it's A-list slasher, but it's probably maybe become a B-list at this point. It's in 4K. That's right. This is insane. Madman in 4K. That's very cool. Oh, they got a brand new interview with lead actress Galen Ross. That's crazy. I wonder if that was on the old edition. I never did get a chance to watch the old edition. I do remember enjoying this movie. It's just been years. So then up we have Biltis. However the hell you say that. Probably mispronouncing it like a jackass, like I always do. Yeah, this is Fun City. I always pick up the Fun City editions, although I haven't had a chance to dive into them. They have a couple titles that look really interesting. So, yeah, one day I just need to... It's hard to keep up with a lot of the titles I have to review and stuff that I have to watch for shows and podcasts and throwing Blu-rays all over the fucking place. Good jackass. We have Tragedy Girls, which I really enjoy. This is an absolute fun movie. Really dark. And I feel like it's kind of predict exactly how people on social media would act. Yep. So, like, as any movie that's, like, gonna kind of, like, condemn social media, like, it's gonna age well, if that makes any sense. So, I hope this is a new print. The old DVD was, like, a made-on-demand disc and everything like that. With, like, I don't even think it had features, which blows. But this is a cool movie, Tragedy Girls. Very enjoyable. Next up, we have American Scream from Culture Shock. Glad to see this one. This is one that I had kind of knew just from the cover. I never did get a chance to see it. I only seen it like on when you first start getting online. You're like, oh, I don't know what that one is. Like, and it has kind of a memorable cover here. Yeah, it's like it looks like a comedic slasher kind of horror movie. Looks fun. It's definitely one that they also put out Girlfriend from Hell, which I haven't got a chance to rewatch, but I kind of like some of the titles they've been doing. Some interesting, fun stuff. What else we got? Okay. Dragues, which is, I think, a Picarama. And I'm not doing French anymore, guys, so it has a bonus film on there. I'm just not speaking French. I'll just embarrass myself furthermore. But Picarama title that came out on Valentine's Day or for the Valentine's Day sale. What else we got in here? Delta Space Mission, which looked like a bizarre animated movie, so I picked this one up. Not too kind of rare for the Vinegar Syndrome sublabels or Vinegar Syndrome to put out animated movies, so when they are released, I'm like, I better kind of grab that one. This is from, what's the company here? I can't remember the names. Jeez, is it like Delta? I can't. Fuck. Of course. Deaf Crocodile Films. This is the Canadian one, right? The new Canadian. They got like 30 sub-labels in like the past like 3 years, so hard to keep up on everything. I just kind of grab what looks interesting to me. Blood on Her Name here is another one. This is a Yellow Veil. I believe Yellow Veil Pictures. They also put out another kind of moderate kind of, I mean, not modern slasher kind of horror film. So, yeah, one looks pretty cool. I love the cover art there. Putting all slip covers back on. Everything's got a slip cover now. Cain and Abel. So, yeah. This was this is another one. What company is this one? This is, I think, their second release. Kind of a new Akani releasing. They put out the Asian film beforehand. So, this one looks really cool. Like I said, I'm into like a lot of the action or horror exploitation from the 70s and 80s. So, most of that stuff, or maybe a modern horror film, I will pick up. Beware the Children, which is the actual Vinegar Syndrome release. This is a trauma picture. I've actually never seen this one. I've had it for years on DVD. I've seen lots of clips from it. Yeah, but crazy kids killing people. I like it. Next up we have We Await and Red Spirit Lake, which are really kind of crazy SOV movies. The director, Charles Pinyon. I reviewed one of these on my channel, and it's a bizarre movie. I believe it's Red Spirit Lake, and I really dug it, so it's cool to see both of these on Blu-ray together. He has another one, too. What is it? Twisted Issues, which came out earlier than these two, and I have not seen that one. He has, like, a made-on-demand, like, disc that I actually bought, like, three of them, and they're real thin. Let me pull them up. So these are, like, upgrades of these for me. Like this is the new edition. It looks very cool. And we have like these old thin cases here, We Away and stuff like that. If nobody's ever seen like his homemade releases, I'm sure they're probably out of print now. Twisted Issues and of course Red Spirit Lake. So yeah, anyways, it's nice to upgrade these bad boys. And like I said, I'll have to check them out when I get a chance. And then what do we got? We got a couple more in here. Moving the audio thing. It's probably going to make bad audio sounds. And then we got, they finally sent the Flesh for Frankenstein replacement disc. Very cool. Dracula Sucks. That's right, another Pikarama one. This is not the Count. It's just going for... What? This time the Count is not just going for a throat. Ah! Jimmy Gillis is in here. John Holmes. That's got some big names in here. Now I can watch kind of porn in 4K. That's right. I want to see every detail. Everything. Okay, and then last up from VSA is Wolfpack, which is kind of an interesting looking movie. Very cool. And one DVD from SOVHorror.com. This is Blood Orgy of the Leather Girls. Yeah. So that one looks cool as well. I guess we're going to hop back to the video. Okay, guys, thank you very much for watching. And as always, have a good one. Peace.